Got no idea. I have got, as they say in the trade, some new shite. So you can be the first to hear that tonight on this birthday meeting. See how we go. See, it's not even on my tablet yet. It's still on my phone. The family's out. The doors are locked. I know I'm on my own. I can almost hear the silence as I sit down on the throne. Trousers around my ankles, a fresh loo roll on the stand. A little gas escapes me. Ah, life, my friend, is grand. Things are different now, though. It's not like it was back in the day, when all you had to read was the plant extracts on Timotei. And if you didn't think ahead and grab the bottle first, you'd be sat there counting tiles, first one way, then reversed. But now I've got my trusty Kindle laying on the shelf, halfway through a book involving policemen and an elf. Retro gaming magazines are also in my loo, except I remember first time round when all this gear was new. I also have my phone for YouTube and the like, or looking up on Google the plumage of a shrike. Facebook, Insta, TikTok, all are in fingers' reach. As is next year's holiday, look, here's a picture of the beach. Prose read, videos watched. Finally, I am done. But as I go to stand up, I can't. My legs are numb. My feet feel like they're filled with lead. I can't lift them off the ground. I try and reach the sink, but I can't even turn around. I wait for circulation, for blood to reach my skin, ignoring shouts across the house of, "Have you fallen in?" My senses finally come back. Well, most of them, anyway. How would I rate my experience? 5 stars. I enjoyed my stay. So that's the first one, people. And I've just got a couple more. There's one I've been trying to find, but I can't find it. It's not downloading. This is a follow-up to one I did called I Wish I Had a Twix. You know when you go out for dinner? I haven't started the poem yet. You know when you go out for dinner and your partner's always insisting on having a bit of your dessert? It's annoying, isn't it? This is a poem about that. I push my knife and fork together. Dinner was divine. I look my partner in the eyes and take a sip of wine. I'd give her everything I have, my heart, my soul, my life. Each day I count my blessings that she agreed to be my wife. I couldn't eat another thing. My stomach starts to hurt. Then a waitress appears from nowhere. Would you like some dessert? It's like she's gone and read me, like the proverbial book. I take the menu out of her hands and have a little look. If I'm being honest, it's the part that I've been dreading, because if it's handled wrongly, it can really do my head in. You see, what I really, really want is a slice of treacle tart. But if I go and order that, the bartering will start. Why don't you order that and pass half of it over? And in return, I'll let you have some raspberry pavlova. But I don't want raspberry pavlova or anything you've got. I want the sticky treacle tart and I want the blinking lot. Or you could have the chocolate brownie, she says with some delight. And I can have the tartatan. I'll let you have a bite. Now, I'll be having cream, she says, so please do as I say. When she takes your order, babe, ask for creme anglaise. I say I'm having crumble. She doesn't like that. It's made with pear. I don't like it either, but at least I don't have to share. So I order crumble with custard, thinking I've been smart. Oh. But when the waitress takes her order, she asks for sticky treacle tart. Thank you very much.
Have we got time?
Yeah, there's your crumble, Gaz. Have we got time for one more? Or
go on, long as you tell everybody what you do on the last Thursday of every month.
That's just between you and me, Gary. No one needs to know that.
I did tell your wife.
Yeah, no, yeah, true enough. She's got the photos. Gary's put a new venue together called Poetry at the Tea Rooms in Wellington, and he's very graciously let me host it with Sophie J.Lo Sullivan, which is lovely, and it's really nice. We have some really fantastic acts there. It's very casual, very calm. People just come along. We've got the teapot of talent. Put your name in the teapot. There's no running order. Put your name in the teapot. We'll pull it out, and you come up. It's great. It's a really, really fun night. And if you're in Peterborough on the last Thursday of every month, please come along. We will definitely make you welcome.
Bye, Bozeman.
Thank you very much. Right, we'll do this one and we'll finish with this. You keep ice cubes in the freezer. Fruit goes in a bowl. Wine lives in a cellar. Puddles in a hole. Cake goes in a cake tin. Astronauts go in a rocket. But why don't people ever use their pyjama biscuit pocket? People think I'm crazy when I mention this aloud, but you've got a biscuit pocket. Fill it. It's allowed. Where else would you put them as you climb the stairs to bed? You'd look a right old numpty with an obnob on your head. One hand to carry your choice of brew, the other opens doors. Unless you use a tray, of course. I mean, you could. The choice is yours. But why fill up your bedroom floor with things that you don't need? Use your biscuit pocket to store them whilst you read. Jammy Dodgers, custard creams, the long-forgot pink wafer. Keep them in your pocket. I promise it's much safer. And that's me. Thank you very much for the opportunity. Cheers, Gary, and we'll see you on Thursday.
I love a pink wafer.
You don't get them anymore, do you? They're not popular anymore. I know.
All those biscuits, they were just great. I'll just put them in my mouth and walk up the stairs.
I never thought of that.
So, thanks. So, next we have one of the funniest guys I have met in poetry. I love a lot of his poems. Jeff Cottril.
Oh, just give me a second. There we go. Okay, so I'll start with this one. A few of you have heard. Sympatica Books, Inc. Dear Mr. Orwell, thank you very much for your interest in Sympatica Books, Inc. We have reviewed your submitted manuscript, The Animal Farm, and we have decided, regrettably, that it is not the right fit for our lineup. Although your novella is well-written and has a few interesting ideas, we feel that it also has some serious issues and needs a lot of work. Our main problem with your manuscript is the characters, specifically that none of them is very likable. There isn't a single one a reader can root for. We feel strongly that main characters in fiction must always be likable and never have any flaws or do anything the reader might disagree with. Most of the pigs in Animal's Farm are so nasty and power-obsessed, and they do many cruel things to the other animals. They kill them. They lie to them and manipulate them. They betray them. How is a person supposed to relate to that kind of behavior? Nobody's like that in real life. And even the animals who are victims of the abuse, you don't feel much for them either, Mr. Orwells. They don't fight back or try to win the day. They just take all the oppression passively. That's so depressing. A reader needs to cheer somebody on to be a hero, but your book doesn't deliver that. Our other big issue with your manuscript is the story itself, that it's just so unbelievable and unrealistic. A group of farm animals drive the owner away and take over the farm? Don't you find that a little far-fetched, Mr. Wells? A little hard to imagine? Animals can get a little rambunctious now and then, but they could never take over a whole farm like that. And even if they did, it's hard to believe that they would run the farm so poorly. There's so much corruption among the pigs that the whole thing turns into a virtual dictatorship. I don't think that could happen even with human beings, let alone with animals. You're not giving the reader much credit. Our team at Simpatica Books, Inc. is confused about your goals for Animal Farms. It's too violent and intense for a kid's book, and it's too dark and pessimistic for a fantasy. We can't imagine what kind of demographic you're aiming for or why anyone would want to spend their free time with these characters. But I have some good news. Our focus group of beta readers has come up with some constructive suggestions that may help you improve your book. There's some button pressing for one, that will help. First, instead of all those mean pigs, why not have one really nice pig? And give the nice pig a friend or two. I think it's sad that you never gave the animals any good friendship, but I bet the reader would love to see one. Maybe the nice pig has a cute little spider friend. A little spider friend who remembers to mute when somebody's reading. That always helps. Maybe the nice pig has a cute little spider friend who weaves nice messages about the pig in her web, and that sends the pig on some fun adventures. Don't you think that would make a good children's book? I think so. And maybe the nice pig learns how to herd sheep and he goes on to win a sheep herding competition. That would send an uplifting message about believing in yourself. Another issue, our beta readers don't like the catchphrase you gave to Boxer the horse. I will work harder. Nobody's ever going to quote that. We came up with a better catchphrase. A horse is a horse, of course, of course. You see, now that's catchy and fun. That's what a reader wants. Well, the point I'm trying to make, after the years pass and we're all rotting in the ground, the generations after us will remember only one thing about our literature. It's marketability. Please keep working hard at your writing. Maybe someday you'll get a lot better at it and write something worth publishing, Mr. Orson. Something with a fun plot and a likable hero. Like that nice Nancy Drew. Now, she's a plucky little one. Why don't you give us a character like that? That would be swell. Sincerely, Simpatica Books, Inc. Books for people who don't want a challenge. So that was called Simpatica Books, Inc. And if I have time for another one, I've got some new shit that I just debuted yesterday. This is a new poem. It's a new poem in which I've decided to take a proto-feminist approach to the Sestina format while examining the male gaze as depicted in the independent Palestinian cinema of the early 1970s, as seen through a prism of Bakhtinian dialogism and post-structural Marxist theory with respect to, no, I'm just kidding. This is about baby slugs. It's called Baby Slugs. Baby slugs, baby slugs, baby slugs. Baby slugs. Baby slugs crawling through the soil and dirt, searching for leaves and grass to feed on. Baby slugs hatching from their tiny eggs, poking out through the layers of debris. Baby slugs slithering over the moist gray rocks. Baby slugs, baby slugs, baby slugs, baby slugs. Baby slugs looking up at the dimming sky, seeing filthy images in the cloud patterns. Baby slugs marching through the park at noon, striking fancy poses for the tourists' cameras. Baby slugs making inappropriate passes at your significant other. Baby slugs, baby slugs, baby slugs, baby slugs. Baby slugs running around like savage maniacs, knocking over your grandfather's antiques. Baby slugs hunching over your study desk, finding new loopholes in your tax documents. Baby slugs, wondering if a Motorhead reunion could work without Lemmy. Baby slugs, baby slugs, baby slugs, baby slugs. Baby slugs looking over the group bar tab, debating if the server deserves a 10% tip. Baby slugs talking too loud at the movies, kicking the back of your seat during the big reveal. Baby slugs screaming rude words at your child's kindergarten teacher. Baby slugs, baby slugs. Baby slugs, baby slugs. Baby slugs planning a violent revolution, sparing only the people with the cleanest socks. Baby slugs plotting world domination, using an egg beater, a rooster, and five Twinkies. Baby slugs naming the galaxies after their favorite Belgian wrestlers. Baby slugs, baby slugs, baby slugs, baby slugs. That was new shit called Baby Slugs. And I've got a couple of things I'm going to put in the chat including my upcoming book, which has no likable characters or believability in it. Oh well.
Thank you, Jeff. I'll look forward to reading your book. Everything you do is just so random but relatable. It's hilarious. Next, and this is not me being egotistical, this is Gary's running order, and it's me. So I've got two for you, one of which is quite sort of deep, and the other which is meant to be funny to try and bring the party atmosphere back a little bit at least. So the first one, which some of you might have heard, is called Dreams. I'm never disabled in my dreams, but I'm starting to wonder whether my dreams are disabled. 5 years old, begging my dad for goalie gloves so I could be like Joe Hart. I didn't understand that the fact I couldn't walk would mean I'd never kick a ball, never mind play for my school team. I did understand that my legs didn't work. In fact, that's why I chose Joe Hart and not Crouchy. I did get to play football in the English top flight for my country, in fact, but not quite how I imagined. The training in the garden never got used. No crowds know my name, and I haven't won Three Lions yet. 7 years old, I'm gonna go to California and make films like Tim Burton. I was writing scripts on my pink Dell laptop, pitching them to my mum like she was Walt Disney. And then I realised how much I struggled physically to make films. And then I realised how few friends I had to be in them. And then someone pointed out the impracticalities of someone like me living in California. Now I do media at college, not in California, but North Yorkshire. And I have still got anxiety around anything but the writing process. 10 years old, listening to Rizzo Kicks, N-Dubs, and Black Eyed Peas. I want to be a rapper, watching YouTube videos, writing lyrics, rapping to my iPod Nano, showing my mum. She was impressed. Showing my friends, not so much. They pointed out my speech impediment. I had never noticed that before. Now I'm a poet, but I'm so self-conscious around pace and performance. 17 years old, here, now, writing this poem, and I just want to move on. As I sit before you, I've just been told I need major spinal surgery. Just as I settled with my life, another curveball. And at the risk of sounding like a spoiled child, I just don't want to deal with it. I'm grateful for where I've got to. Grateful to be alive, but I'm sick of having to budget my bucket list. I guess I just wonder where I'd have got if the path wasn't scoliosis twisted like my spine. Sorry for bringing the mood down a little bit. And in between my poems, I have to let some people in from the waiting room. So if you'll give it a second, that would be great. The next is a bit sillier, and it's called Superman. Is it a bird? Is it a plane? No, it's a bigot. Yes, that's right. Superman's son is bisexual and people are outraged. When I say people, I mean people that are not invested in the franchise at all. Very few fans care. After all, in the Venn diagram of nerds and the LGBTQ community, there's a massive crossover. Plus, they know the facts. Speaking of which, let's review. The main panic headline I've seen circulating is DC have turned Superman gay. One, the character is bisexual, so we can assume he likes all genders, including female. Two, it's not like anyone ever explicitly said he was straight. You lot don't have to make the effort of coming out, remember? Three, the joy of the comic books is the amount of multiverses we have. Not everything has to be original canon. Four, and this is a big one, he's not even Superman. He's his son who, for less than a decade, has had major minor parts in minor comics. I'm a huge fan. If this was affecting the purity of the franchise, I would be the first one to be outraged. But the only thing that makes me angry is that masculinity is still related to sexuality. Even if it was the hero himself that was bisexual, surely it wouldn't make him any less impressive. And it's even more hurtful when the cast takes on the mantra of Clark Kent, condemn the decision. Dean Cain, nobody's trying to give you a sex change and you can still snog Lois. Seriously though, why can't comic book leads be bi or gay? If we can't be heroes, you're kind of villainizing us by proxy. You're telling us we can't be strong, that we'll always be less than super. You LGBTQ people who look at these characters may feel it conflicts with their identity, but he doesn't. After all, Tom Daly is gay, and can't he pretty much fly in real life? Thank you. I might be slightly wrong in the running order, and if I am, I'll correct it later. But I believe next is one half of Ubi Hive, Clive Osman.
Hello. What am I, Oo or Beehive?
I think Nick could call you Ubi Quiet this week.
Yeah. Especially after the other night. Right, I'm going to do my three newest poems. A couple of them some of you will have heard. The other one is, I've always admired people who can write univocals just using one vowel throughout the whole poem. And it's really, really difficult. But I've written one, it's quite short. And it's about my experiences this week moving house, or moving flat as it is. And it goes like this. Just use the letter A. It works every time. Right, okay. So, I've been experimenting with silly stuff, as I tend to do. And this first one I'm going to do now is every B in the poem becomes a D, and every D becomes a B. It's as if the keys were in the wrong place on the keyboard. And it's called Bottle Trouble. Hello. Oh, hang on a minute. Hello. You know me as Clive Osman. Dot my real name is Big Bastably Osman. I think my parents were absolute dastards calling me that. Dot, it could have been worse. Have they been fans of the Hoddit? I may have been Dildo Daggins. Dean Big Bastardly, teeing pick bastardly was dabbing off. Thus I would have spent my life sodding uncontrolledly if I were a dildo. If they have a taste for licorice all sorts, I could de dirty dass it. Dilly Dunter would have been another possibility. My parents live in a dungalow now, but they never have much upstairs, if you ask me. Yadda bada boo, as Fred said. Obviously, Dean Sabble with a stupid name, because my parents were bond fucks, has had a detrimental effect on my life. My daughter calls me Babby, and I never could watch Ken Bob with his Bibby men. But what sympathy do I get? Bibbly squat. They even made me read the Didal when I was a kid. All that stuff about Gob, Jesus and his 12 bicycles. And that Jubus was a dit of a bick, wasn't he? For company, I rely on a pet bog. I want a Badoxa, a Balmation, or a sausage bog. Dot Enbibop with a pooble. When I write, I listen to music. Dark, Beethoven, Baby Davy, Duster Rhymes, or Dat to the 60s with Busty Springfield. I was watching some movies yesterday. Ghost Dusters, The Bam Dusters, Dram Stoker's Dracula. And it struck me that so many of the stars are no longer with us. They are drowned dreb, as beb as a bobo. I'm throwing a party at New Year. Drink your own dottle. I'm inviting famous people, including Doris Johnson, Bryan Addett, and a couple of former US presidents, Darack O'Dama and George Budder, you dush. You may think it was difficult to get them, but it was an absolute bubble. As a donor, Prince Andrew has bone a runner, and be will not de attending. So you can drink your kibs. Doris is drinking all his kibs, so I'll duck the Elders Hall in London to fit them all in. Oh, dollocks, it's not digging off. Thank you very much. And
woo!
And
that was hilarious.
Thank you. It's the most difficult thing I've ever written. The next one is a similar principle. It's swapping letters around, but it's much easier to do. And this is changing the letters F and P. And it's called When F and P Change Places. This foeing, if that's what it is about nothing in particular, just various bits and feces. I don't like to start with politics, a peeled pull of fist fucks and fanatics who couldn't organise a fiss off in a brewery. And in the case of UK immigration policy, responsible for plenty of fatalities. Though I'm sure they will be reported favourably by Pox News and its British equivalent with Nigel Farage and his friends. So let's be more pliffant and talk about sports feeful like Feet Sampras. Famous feeble, prom the fast, like Napoleon Bonaparte, or even contemporary feeble, like the unfortunately not yet dearly departed Fiers Morgan, or Katie Hopkins, who always looks like she's paused a pineapple off her bum. No? Okay, let's talk music. You may have an eclectic taste ranging from the Poo-Piters through offerers like the Magic Plute and old British hit like hit British hits like XTC's Making Flans Poor Nigel. I'd poison them. Wartime classics like Fack Off Your Troubles, Beatles classics like I Peel Pine, seasonal songs like On the First Day of Christmas, My True Love Sent to Me a Partridge in a Fear Tree, or even some frog rock. I wish I was musical. I'd go on tour, entertaining the pee-faying public in places like Finland, Portugal, France, and probably Newfoundland. But enough of that. Let's talk pooed. I'm not sure what to eat today. Roast pork and apple sauce or pish and chips? And if pish and chips, Do I have pickled onions or mushy feet? Or do I have a fucker steak and kidney pie? Not saying I eat too much poo that's unhealthy and fattening, but my clothes are size trifle XL. Feet are five for fit to feck up fickled feffers. What? Flagiarism! Puck up! Or I'll front your lights in. Ooh, appended are we? I fray you don't call the felice, the coffers, the pilth, the figs. Puck the felice! Oh, come on, I was joking. I wouldn't really front you. I don't approve of pisty cups or violence of any kind. I'm a fassy pist. My house has fatio doors. It's a big house. It's rather fallacial. What? With a games room for fool and fing-fong. Okay, I'm taking the feast. I live in a folky little plat or apartment, if you prefer, among the pheasants. And I'm probably stuck here until the grim reefer comes calling. Whatever a reefer is. Thank you very much.
Woo! You're so clever.
So, I...
Yeah?
Can we book Clyde for January the 27th?
January the 27th? What day of the week's that?
A Thursday.
Thursday. I will do my best. I will let you know.
Yeah, we'll clear the roads for you.
In between the next few poets, I think Justar's kind of introduces my amazing girl host and possibly do a song, although that might be later. I don't know. I've already messed up the running order. Sorry, Gary.
No, there's no running order in this crazy place as Gary's world. Hello, everyone. I'm really sorry that I was a bit late. As you see, you might have seen my concentration face, so that would have been a laugh because I had technical issues. So, but Kizzy, you take a little 5-minute, well, 2-minute breather, and I'm going to play something, and I've got to put my party hat on for it because it's a birthday party. Hey. It's not quite as good as Gary's. Here we go. Let's see if you lot can hear this on speakers. Can you hear it? Can you hear it? Yeah.
Whoa.
It's got to be done, innit? Whatever. We love you, Gary. Everybody, take yourself off mute.
Birthday, oh, you do.
Yeah.
Happy
birthday.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
Time for that combo.
So pull up. Okay, I'm reloading. I just done a short version. We could do a little remix of Gary Sing.
Yeah.
Okay, everyone on mute for the next one. Everyone's got on mute for the next clip. Come on. Get into it. I want to hear you in the back. I want to hear you in the front. Ready? Go, Gary.
Happy birthday to you.
And custard.
Yeah. First apple crumble of the night.
As my grandma says. Pardon? So sorry, I just had to throw that in there, put my party hat on, and get into the groove of everybody else. So hope that's give everyone a little.
Just start. I've literally got, you know, I've got my wingman here. I've got Kizzy. I've got Justar. I've got my wagging finger.
Dean, got your apple crumble.
I've got my apple crumble. I've got my favourite football team of the North, the Robbie Savages, Macclesfield. I've got Leslie. Oh. And just to throw it much more, we've got Clive and Dane and Hill and Francesca from Nashville. Do you know what? I've maybe had a crap day, but I'm already having a great day. Thank you, everyone, for being here. and sharing in my apple crumble. So I just, your hair looks great.
Well, thank you. I did it just for you. I didn't mean, I just threw some water in it and, you know, it's not till everyone. Anyway, back to you, Kizzy, because I don't know who's next. I'm sorry. I'm a bit slack today.
Okay. Actually, it's one of my closest poetry friends, Michael Fields Pride, Hannah Edge.
Evening all. I don't know if you can see, but we have guests here tonight in the
Macclesfield. There's only one Robbie Savage, one Robbie Savage. Guys, if you ain't got a football team, make Macclesfield your second team. If you've already got one. If you haven't got a team, make Macclesfield.
They're amazing. They're adorable. And they're like 7, 8, 9 leagues down because we went bump and Robbie Savage and Rob Smethers saved our asses and brought us back to life, which is beautiful. So I'm going to start with a different poem, though. I am going to do you some sport, but I've had a really shit week and I wrote something about it and it made me feel better. So I kind of want to expunge it here with you guys, you beautiful peeps, if that's okay. I'll give you a smidge of context. I got fired yesterday for the second time in 3 months as a direct result of my autism. So I'm fucking pissed off. Really pissed off with it. So yeah, there's a couple of swear words in this, so not really sorry about that though. But yeah, so I thought I'd give you this first. It's called That's Business. I could stand on your rooftop with a huge banner dripping blood red paint that says fuck capitalism. But capitalism, the Tories, economy being number one, money your only worry, is not the reason I'm jobless. Lack of morals, lack of scruples, no empathy, pure psychopathy is at the root of your choice to discriminate. You roll around in your bed of cash, chant mantras that it's all worthwhile for the sake of your fully detached house, for the sake of a life filled with gadgets, for the sake of your crisp tailored suits. You lose no sleep at thoughts of my stomach growling, the bailiffs at my door, al fresco bedroom, now I can't make rent. There's no drop of doubt when you kick me to the curb, no shred of care that I can't help being disabled. As you count your coffees, your state, you state it's not your fault that this is how the world works. Heaven forfend that I dared to pause in a world of lights and noise and motions. Heaven forfend that I risked standing still to breathe and press my reset button. Heaven forfend that I naively thought that the laws on disability would protect me. I should have known, should have seen that you'd learn from politicians that you copy what they do when they find another fucking loophole. I should have known, should have seen that life really isn't fucking fair, that scum rises to the top and drowns us in its mold. I could stand on your rooftop and scream into a megaphone that we need to fuck capitalism, but instead I'll say fuck you to the minions that wear it as a badge, as an excuse to be a cunt. So yeah, so I feel a bit better for that. So I'm going to move straight on to something positive.
Amazing. Absolutely crucial. Crucial.
Yeah, I'm angry. I'm not sad, I'm just pure anger at it. So yeah, we're going to do some sport though, because I can't stay on anger. That's not healthy. So
you could always kill another song if you want to get out some anger. We won't kill anybody, we'll just kill another track.
Definitely, definitely, man. That sounds cool to me.
Let's see what you got. We'll play a track after.
Cool, I'm up for that, definitely. So this is called Red Meets Blue, and I wrote this on Monday. So this is brand new as well, to be fair. But this is nice, I promise. Red Meets Blue. Hi, nice to meet you. Do you like footy? Oh, me too. Who's your team? Oh, I'm a red, but I love you dudes too. No, really. I love the sport first. My team are close second. I saw you guys last night, to be fair. That, insert their main striker's name, is a little beauty, eh? But you're buzzing, you signed in. what made me choose this side of the city? Shirt colour. No, really. I know we're successful now, but I promise you, I did. I lived the fallow years, the hopeful years, the broken tears and weekly fears, the 35 mil flops, the late goal losses, the sight of the enemy lifting all those trophies, the pain of the silver, bronze or less, the ache I feel from the fans in blue. Jubilation in the opposition is a hand on my heart that squeezes till I burst. But I swear I'm not jealous, not one jot, because I thumb through the history, the two centuries of football. I see you had some dry spells, that we all ride this roller coaster, all dance with joy at some point or another. Yeah, I bet you did enjoy those years, but footy doesn't make a friendship, so let's talk about your cracking goalie. So there you go. That's about loving football, no matter who you are and no matter who you support, whether it's City or United, basically. So, yeah. Have I got time for one little more? One little one that's about football again?
Gary will love it.
You sure? Nice one. Thank you. This one's called Watch and Pray. Some of you might have heard this one before because it's from my book. So, yeah, Watch and Pray. See the modern dance on the holy watered turf, the yells and the pacing of the track-suited coach, the oomph of the ball as it leaves a player's foot, praise for the keeper as he leaps like his wings, joyous in the crowd as in unison we sing. This heart pumps with football, calcio, soccer, football, tiki-taka, gegenpress, Bielsa, ball, all park the bus. The chips and the flicks, back passes, headers, goalies from playmakers, strikers, fullbacks, last-minute scrambles, off-the-line clearances. Match of the day fanfare, Chris Kamara gaffes, transfer speculations and youthful revelations, insane sums for unknown journeymen, it's red versus blue, king versus country, dreams coming true when a team knows how to dance. Time for the weekend ritual of praying to a ball. Armchair is our prayer mat where we cry, cheer, jeer. Living for the derby, the championship fights, cup winning nights and relegation plights. We keep our faith, win, lose or draw. Thank you. That's me done.
Oh, Hannah. We need to send a train up to Macclesfield and get you down here. Get you there. Don't be sorry. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I was on mute. Yeah, no, absolutely. Yeah. We have
Clive and Hannah on the same night.
Yeah.
Christine and Leslie.
Get them all down, guys. Get them all down.
All down.
After party.
Yeah. Hannah, we need to talk. Back your book.
Yes.
Put it in.
I'll share a link. Yes. Yeah. I'm so crap at that self promo thingy majig. It's so rubbish. Yeah. I'll get the link now.
All right.
Okay. Well, do you want to introduce the next person? Sorry. Who's that? Sorry, T.
Oh, sorry. I was just going to say to Hannah, it's really important to promote. Give me a shout if you need any help. Tish Social.
I will definitely look you up, mate. Nice one. Thank you. I'm shit at it.
So should we bring on the next person? I think next we've got Bryan from the Right Club, if I'm correct. If I'm right, from the Right Club, but not that sort of right.
Yes, we have Bryan F. Gerger.
Take away the stage. Sorry, Kizzy.
Go on, chaps. Right. As I'm new to this little wonderful soiree, I'm going to ask you a simple question. Do you want to pick one or two? Thank you, Dane. I'm going to keep it short then. Massive. Maybe with your feet anchored to the ground, some things might look slightly bigger than they actually are. In fact, when you look through the vision of the glass, everything seems bigger than it should be. And one good turn deserves another. So, if I can find it. I don't know if you've got trams down there, but I have. I wrote this one about a little feathered friend that followed me onto the Metrolink one day. So here goes nothing. Manchester, be aware. Even the birds think their dinner is taking the mick. Riding along for Nouts on the system from Salford to Ashton. Like weavers of old Manchester, they leave interesting little webs that go down the carriage. Northern temperatures seem to suit them. Kings of the carriage till the end of the line.
Bryan?
Yeah?
Bryan. All right. Some of those don't know you that you're, I think you're in the red end of Manchester.
Listen, I've got a get out clause now.
Yeah, I've got a get out clause.
I support a team called Salford City.
Ah, okay. It's all owned by Reds.
If they're the Tangerine crew.
What's wrong with FC United?
FC United is a little bit out of my way.
Oh, okay. Right. Stuck with the Glazers then for a little longer, did you?
The American millionaires live just down the road from me.
Yeah, well, we'll come to you. Kizzy would tell you, I've lost her on the screen, Kizzy would tell you that twice a week we meet up with Mr. Bryan from at White Club, and he all give him anything, any words, he's able to make a poem about it. We have a thing where we have a theme of the week.
Hey, now that sounds like a challenge, you guys.
Yeah, so I would appreciate if people just throw things in the chat for Bryan to make a poem out of, and we'll come back to him when he's not ready.
And if anyone...
Kizzy, wrong, you do that, retribution will be swift and terrible.
You can't threaten me. At the moment, I live 2 hours away from you, so you can't do anything. If anyone...
That was a warning.
If anyone fancies Red Club, it's the most amazing community. It's someone called it therapy for poets, and there's not a better definition for it. We just gather twice a week and chat, and it's lovely. Mark Grist runs it. So if anyone wants to get involved in that, we have a Facebook page. But yeah, I'll shut up and just added thing.
Never shut up. Keep doing what you're doing. Keep promoting what you're promoting. That's what it's all about. Okay, next, I want to jump on. One of my friends actually is on here. I've known her for a long time. Her name is Nicola Oliver, officially on the screen there. She's going to drop us some wicked poetry now, so pick it up.
Hello. Right, let me just run upstairs because it's too noisy in my living room for you guys to all hear me. I should be better organised than this, but I'm not. Hang on.
You're going to get out of breath by the time you read your poem.
I don't. I've got two flights of stairs in my house. It's a killer. Oh, dear. Right.
All right, just keep your breath. Good. Keep your breath.
I'm good. So, firstly, happy second birthday, Pick a Mix. My first poem is called The Mother of All Mondays. The cat woke me up, then I slept through my alarm. No hope in hell of keeping calm. No time for a shower. I don't want to stink. So I'm washing face and armpits over the bathroom sink. Eat this over its wrapper. It saves washing a plate. Hurry up, sunshine, or you'll be late. Then they utter the words no child should ever speak. Can you help me with my homework? It was due last week. Are you having a laugh? I cry in despair, searching under the sofa for a shoe to make a pair. Mum, the dog's just been sick on our brand new carpet. Well, then fetch me the things I need to scrub it. There's a missing PE top and a little one crying aloud. I want to go back to bed, not deal with this crowd. Motherhood was meant to be a heart full of wishes, not Monday mornings and sinks filled with dishes. And mothers are meant to be virtuous and blessed, not some sleep deprived, disorganized, grumpy, nervous wreck. But I got them out the door and in their schools on time. The dramas of our morning will soon be forgotten, just as soon as it's home time. And all of that was based on an actual Monday morning for me.
I was about to say, I'm sure a lot of people can relate, because I know people, I don't have kids, but I know people that running around in the morning trying to find a shoe, like...
Yeah. Yep. And the next poem I wanted to share with you all is kind of a little like an apology type poem called Smile. Apology / thank you. So I wanted to say thank you for forcing me to smile in all of the moments I'm moody and grey and vile. You have this unique ability to lift me when I'm down, to make me dance in the rain, make my smile replace my frown. And even when I don't want to, you persevere until you win, relieving me of all my burdens, allow me to carry nothing but a grin. All I can do is hope that I do the same for you and make your face ache from smiling when it's the last thing you want to do. Because nothing makes me happier than seeing you smile and hearing your laugh, which is why I know for certain that we're each other's better half. So the only thing I can promise you is that I'll make you smile forever, because our facial expressions say it all. We're our happiest when we're together. And thank you. My last one, I did debate on which one I should share with you, because I do appreciate that either one is a bit ridiculous. But I thought, as it's a birthday party and we're going for, you know,
the more ridiculous, the better. Look at Gary, he's swimming in the
ridiculous, the better. So this was my attempt at writing. I don't know where this came from. It started off as a poem. By the time I finished it, it was more like a little radio jingle. But here we go. Chips, they're veggie, they're vegan, they're kosher and halal, and they taste so great with a piece of steak that meat lovers love them too. They're gluten, dairy and nut free. No one has a chip allergy, and they taste so great from the oven to your plate that Weight Watchers love them too. I actually can't believe I'm like singing this live to people. Peel them, slice them, soak them in a pan, drain them, fry them, get them from a chippy van, because they taste so great on their own or with a mate, and your grandpa loves them too. Skinny, chunky, make them fancy if you can, steak cut, curly, brown sauce for your gran, because they taste so yum when they're cooked by your mum that nobody can refuse them. Wedges, Frenches, crinkle or skin on, a tiny bit of seasoning you can't go wrong, because they taste so great from the fryer to your plate that chefs just love chips too.
Somebody sign her up for the jingle. Wow, that's something. Yeah. Yeah. That's amazing.
Love that, mate. Oh.
That's like a glass and a half of Prosecco's bravery there for you.
Yo, bring it on. Take two glasses, see what more you got, because that was wicked.
Emma, no reason to be nervous. You smashed it.
Oh, dear. Well, Nikki, I have to tell you, was...
Nikki, when you first came onto Zoom, I had a panic attack coming all over me, because my ex-sister-in-law called Nikki Oliver, and I literally went...
Oh, really?
Yeah. Oh.
Oh, can I ask if anyone managed to get me on the list? Kizzy, did he pass that over at all to Justar?
We'll sort it out, don't you worry.
I haven't passed it over yet, but I have you on my list on my computer. We're a bit hectic, but you will be in the second half, and so will Hill.
Well, anyone else want to big up anything to Nicola? Because I think her glass and a half Prosecco Bravery there smashed it. And it makes me want to have some chips. Don't know about you lot. I want the crinkly ones, the straight ones, the brown sauce, the tomato ketchup, yo.
I just got a bit
carried away when I started writing it.
Nah, that was wicked. And I really think that McCain's need to get something done with you there.
I keep saying to my partner, like, you laugh now, but when I'm making money, every time you hear that on the radio when you're working.
I believe it. And it's true. No one's allergic to chips, are they?
No one's allergic to chips.
Yeah, I noticed that when you're saying
that. Mm. And they're halal, they're kosher, they're everyone, vegans, everyone's good with chips.
Literally, yeah. Record that on your phone, on whatever recording app you've got, and upload it. If you can, with some pictures of chips, and that is your marketing video, and you just chuck it out there.
Yeah, I'd need
absolutely get make I'd that go viral. I'd need
a marketable voice first.
You got it. You're the chip woman now. That's it. Brown sauce. I'm like, yes. Because I'll be like, yes, and the brown sauce, yes.
I've got some salt and vinegar as well.
Perfect. Right, I will go because I'll let other people take their turn. But happy birthday. Thank you for having me. I'm going to carry on watching the show. I've loved it so far. Mwah.
Right, so I'm not sure what's going on now. What's going on now, Kizzy? Help me out here. You've got a bigger list than me.
I think it's supposed to be the man himself, so I don't know whether you want to handle that or whether I should. Or whether
maybe we should tag team that. I think that's a tag team job, you know?
Yeah, I think so too. So I
hope he's ready. He doesn't look very ready.
Some of you may know him as Mr. Triple H. Some of you may know him as Gary Huskinson. Some of you may know him as the leader of Say It Louder. But for once, he's doing a poem at his own event. I'll let you carry on.
I was going to say, some of you may know him as beep, beep. No, I'm joking. Never have I ever said that in my life. Some of you know him as Uncle Gary.
I spent my life going on about these two wonderful women I've got, Justar.
Stop telling lies.
I can't do an event without them. Anyway, after me is Generalismiso, isn't it? That's what's next.
I think there's a few other people, but then I think there's like one.
Okay, more. All right. I'll be very quick because I've got a revelation. I'm sort of I was saving for poetry, but I've got my big boy pants on. I've got to do one and see if I dare say it. Anyway, so, I spend my life in and out of A&E. In fact. A waiting room is like sitting in casualty, waiting to see what's going to happen to me. There's babies bawling, porters pantering, bleeding men muttering, and mums and wives waiting. What's going to happen to me with my little prick injury? My needle injury is waiting for the firing squad to call your name. I'm looking at the second hand go. Round and round again. Increase your chances of your ailments going away. The flickering of a vintage photography magazine, the Reader Digest, is the only sound. So I read all the self-help posters put up by the pharmacy. Do this, take that, take 5 a day, lose some pounds. I don't smoke. I think I should start so I can give up today. So I play. And I want all you to play the next time you're in that waiting room. I play the waiting room game just in case I go insane. Ladies and gentlemen, for the next 6 hours, we're going to play What's Wrong With The Waiting Room Is. If you get 2 out of 3 of correct, you would win a supply of Reader's Digest painkillers and a subscription to Town and Country magazine. Woo! Let me see what I can see. First in the corner is a growing toenail in the middle. In the middle, a case of, let me see, middle-aged herpes. And in the front, men problems, I do could tell. And there's that resident woman finding out which chair is comfy. The red light comes on. Mr. Babbage, and says my name wrong. It's my turn for the firing line. Firing's quite funny. A nurse, well, a PYT, a pretty young thing, hairdresser called Tracy, straddles out with a needle. Hurry, hurry, I need to inject you, Gary. Don't worry, I'm used to little pricks. You have won the booby prize. What? Prize in, what's wrong with me? Oh dear, dear me, oh, help me. Now, I've been thinking about this poem, this once I've done it once, it may never get again. I'm just checking, I've got no relatives and no one knows exactly where I live. As some of you know, I go in and out of hospital and always visit A&E. You know, I've got a heart condition, I've got hypertension, I've got gravitation, I've even got type 2 diabetes. I just go for the whole stamp collection. But I got a letter, not for a jab, not even for a booster jab, but they say, because of your diabetes, we have to give you a circumcision. I go, what? Hey, what? Oh. And we want you to come 2 weeks ago. For 2 weeks, I get nervous. I look at my little member, well, my member, I won't even tell you the size. I'm sorry to do it to you. We've been together forever, but time, they might even turn me into a Tottenham support. How dare they? This, my life could be ruined forever. I get there, lovely and cool. And to my right, there's a man from the RAF. He's having a vasectomy. His girlfriend brings up, we're having a party. We're having a party tonight. Bring out the champagne. But to my left, there's somebody from the army. He's obviously been playing away. He's having another vasectomy. He said, darling, darling, I'm doing this for you. Please forgive me. I wouldn't do it. I didn't need to do it with your sister, Q. Please, I'm doing this all for you. Both of them, my right and left, go in before me. While I stand there, really looking at my member, sorrily. Then comes the nurse, Nurse Martha. Gary, it is your turn next. We come to give you the needle. Where do you want it? Oh, I'm pointed to the porter. He can have it. I don't want it. But they took me there anyway, dragged. And my sister said, you're going. As I opened the doors, they said, because you've got a heart condition, we can't give you. But you've got to stay awake and watch your member be taken away. This is not to a different condition. I lie there, and the doctor, I just see this great pen on the bed, this great pair of scissors pointing at me. Is this the end for that person formerly known as Gary? I did not know. I sweated, the doctor came over with a smile. He goes, don't worry, Gary. This is the 5th one I've done today. I'm not able to do them now. I said, my words to him can't be repeated because my mum's in a room. She thinks I never swear. Not even that, the doctor. He goes, Gary, we can put your playlist, whatever playlist you want. And I thought, you must be taking the mickey. So I asked for some R&B. And I thought, this can be easy to relax me. So the first, unbeknown to me, the doctor was just basically taking the mickey. So I lied there as he started, he took the scissors pointing. And first on the tune to come out from his Bluetooth, on this, what I now call my circumcision playlist, was, the first cut is the deepest. Oh no! Oh no, I lay there. Pardon them for saying it, because I said, Doctor, you're taking the piss. He goes, no, don't bully. We can do this. He told me to relax. Relax! I don't even relax at the dentist when I'm having a feeling, let alone when you're taking parts of me that are gone forever. The next track came. And it was, you know that tune, you think you know it well, you hear it in the shops, but it was Take That. And all I could hear was it's Back for Good. And I was going, it's not Back for Good. This time, both all the nursing homes are living, and the tunes went by, and I thought, I'm never going to be ever doing a living. But next tune, what came on, and I just had to laugh. Was Michael Jackson. And I was going, I'm black, I'm white, no, I feel I'm in the shite. He goes, it was Billie Jean. And I thought, I'm not going to do what Michael Jackson's and hold his groin when it goes out. But let me just read you the words. People always tell me, be careful what you do. And I went to grab my groin and I started to cry. And don't go around breaking young girls' heart. I ain't going to do that now, more am I? This, as I went along, the next song up was played was from my favourite, Stevie Wonder. God, no wonder. I felt like the doctor was blind. Because then he played, Lady in Red, give it to me. I saw he put his head around. He was covered in blood. And I was like, oh, no. Oh no, I know, I couldn't be, I won't be no more, Gary. I'm just going to dissolve my little piece of wood. As time went by, and I saw all the blood, and the doctor started chuckling, and I asked him how long to go, and all he did was said, we haven't even started cutting. I went, you what? He goes, I'm only joking. It then came along and it said, all this blood I could see going around because I couldn't see. And next song come, you couldn't even believe I wrote it. It was sex bomb, sex bomb, sex bomb. And as blood spurt out and stitches been put in, the doctor was singing along. I didn't, the first time, I should be proud of something to stand up to because the nurse who was cracking up would have to bandage my member and why she sung Sex Bomb, which is basically a first for me, that no woman has to hold my member and sang it to me. By now, my life had gone. The following song, I know the doctor. I knew this was tragic and all. I thought, I know what's going to become. It's going to be S Club going, tragedy! But no, it wasn't. When he told it, he said, it's going to take 4 weeks for you to heal. So don't be careful what you do with it. I'm being really careful because... And I said, I don't know. And then came on that song. It was another take one. Could it be magic now? And I went, no, it can't be magic. The doctor and all the nurses are now cracking up. And I was lying there with tears down one side and body, I could just feel the blood dripping. And he goes, we're almost there now, Gary. You've been an excellent patient. You've made us laugh. And I thought, well, please tell me where. Give me a taxi to the crematorium. But the doctor had just one more thing. This is why he had one more song to sing. Why he was stitching and pricking my foreskin. He started singing YMCA. Young man, there's a place you can go. He said, young man. And I literally said to him, there's no place I can go. I'm stuck here forever. He just thought, laughed and thought. He played a song by Royal Blood. And just to come to the bloody end, and I mean the bloody end, he thought it'd be a good crack to come off the playlist and play Sunday Bloody Sunday. He knew my favourite colour was blue. The dear nurse song put a blue bandage on. And I went, yes, blue is a colour. And football was my game. And then I just thought, he asked me to roll off into the wheelchair, want to take me away. And as they did, I thought they couldn't take the Mickey anymore. But they played a song by Blue, All Rise. And I said, oh, you can hear me going down the corridor. Not for 4 weeks. Waiting in vain. So there's a poem. I swore I would not do it. I was waiting to do it at the 27th, but now I've cracked it amongst some friends. Oh, please, let's get on. I've done my piece. Thank you.
Wow. That's wow. Flipping neck. Did they look after you afterwards? Did you get anything? Cup of tea? Sweet cup of tea and some biscuits? Anything?
No. You must have got a sticker or a lollipop.
A sticker or something, yeah.
Pink
wafer, mate.
Probably milkshake.
Get pink wafer, mate.
Pink wafer.
No.
Very brave. Oh, my God.
So if anyone knows why, once in a while I've been coming for the past 3-4 weeks.
Okay. Just to let people know a bit about the poets kind of coming up, because I'll take full responsibility for. I'm the only one with a proper running order, but I've got about 3, so I'm a bit confused. But up next is Natalie, then it'll be Chris Dickinson, then it'll be Generalismiso, and then if we want a break, Gary, I don't know what the plan is with regards to breaks.
I thought about if we during the break we show Dane's film.
Oh, I thought that was supposed to be after the break, but yeah, we could do that.
I don't know, check that with Dane.
Oh, that was going to be my set.
Okay, all right, we won't then. We'll just have a quick toilet break.
Yeah, and then we'll work it out from there once me and Justar have had another discussion. But,
Kizzy, I've just noticed my good friend from Scotland has just walked in. It'd be great if he's a grandfather again. So just a real wish him congratulations for that.
Woo!
I honestly do not get, I ain't got a clue what goes on in that taxi cab of his for so many grandchildren, but hey.
It's great grandchildren, Gary, get it right.
Great grandchildren.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you, my friend.
Oh, next, anyway, he's one of the most interesting people I've met through poetry, a really clever linguist, and just our own legend, Natalie.
Is that me?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks, Kizzy. Nice introduction. That threw me. Okay. Hey, listen, I've been living in Finland for about 6 years now, and like I've lived in a few other different countries in the world, but I've noticed that Finland has difficulty accepting foreign cultures. They are very good. It's a new thing. Immigration's a new thing to Finland because, like, there was an influx of refugees in the 90s from Kurdistan and again in the last few years, of course, with the big movement right across Europe. But other than that, Finland hasn't really had too many foreigners moving there or here. So I thought I'd write them a set of instructions because they're very good at bureaucracy and writing policy and procedure to that. So I thought I might help them out a little bit. And I took these instructions, I took the inspiration for these instructions from washing machine instructions, how to fit a washing machine. So I'll just play the part here. These are the instructions for integration. Right. Here's the new prototype from overseas. Avert your eyes though, she's not quite right. Cautiously unpack the imported model and confirm survival. Parts are all there, all correctly labelled, but there's only foreign elements available. Step one. Step four, resilient console, emergency drain hose and a release lever, adjustable feet, caution, spanner in the works, language adaptation notably slow. Step two, slot chipboard in for a sturdy backbone. Connect select past A to current C. Insert new code for conformity. Listen, according to the documentation, it states quite clearly requirements, functions, practically speaking, this model is not right. Adherence to Regulation 1B, Part 5, Section 3, advised by the board of what's necessary. Your qualifications of qualities do not quite meet what we have on this sheet. Step 3. Clear debris of prior experience in case of resistance. Tighten the nut. Ready for trial installation. Step four. Slow start. Green light, though. Yes, cogs tight. Oh, dear, own thought. Oh, shit, foot caught. Conveyor belt stuck. Systematic packing compromised. Shit, pull emergency lever. Sound the siren. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no need to panic. Motor creak. Smoke seeps, cogs seethe, frost gurgles out, and smoke bursts through the cracks like volcanic ash. Malodor permeates as the grimy green algae on the still summer lake. Drag out the sludge. Clear debris filter and reset. For best chance of integration, allow for entire past and reconnect to currency. Reassess factory criteria to include, can't read without my glasses now, to include international standards. Allow space for unorthodox conduct. Feet may need to level in own measure. Inspect debris filter for hidden gems and investigate outside the box. Thank you. I haven't done that one for a while, so that's a little bit of fun. This next one, I'm going to give a content warning for effects of substance abuse. Lawn's overgrown, but we carry on. Kitchen's a mess. as I place it lower my priority list. You see, long ago I was free. I tried to be me, but my eyes got bigger than my greed. I keep looking for her, rose in the booth. Untraceable, displaceable, a pain in the spleen, an idiosyncrasy. I've got the makings of an old, unshaven, stinking, mature coward, all delivered in the body of a curvaceous, worldly coward. But enough of this self-hatred. I've got oats to sow, grow, and show the wisdom of my ways. Oh, those highs. How time flies. Damn lies follow me everywhere. I tried till I stopped. Deeply pulled people's fear eagerly around. Feverish glances, cheek to the ground. Feet uneven weave of the carpet mound. That last desperate round from the illustrious gold dust left unfurled. White walls crawl and the paranoia falls. Spent normalcy brawls against the repealed fear of the mundane. Without a dry eye spies the frightened child. Shallow cough barely touches the sides. Sweet infiltration leaves. The life's castration. Pulse up, seeps and probes the murky alleyways. And my wry smile subsides in reply and reminds me of times gone by. Been a while. I'm going to leave it there tonight. Thank you.
They were both really thought-provoking, and the first one was really witty. I really enjoyed that first one particularly. I think a lot of it can be applied to Britain, to be honest.
Yeah, thanks, Kizzy.
Up next is, I think, one of the most calming voices in Peterborough, in my experience, Chris Dickinson.
Oh, thank you. Time to go to sleep then, everybody. Thanks, Kizzy. I thought I'd read you this one because it's it mentions birthdays, and it is a birthday after all, isn't it? We love the mirror in the sturdy frame, the jags of carving in the mellow wood, intrigued in a junk store by the story of salvage from a life at sea. We welcomed its presence into our home, drilled holes, fitted raw plugs, tightened the screws. We hang our celebrations here, display our birth dates, parties, anniversaries. The hall is brighter, light cast back in glass, returning the ins and outs of family, doubling the smiles of guests, passers-by, the once-over glances by the doorway, a scarf knotted, tie straightened, hair raked, one gloved hand clutching another. A child bounced face to face grows tall, and cats in baskets come and go, a friend fades, and visits from grandmas bowed under baggage dim, no longer part of the furniture. I ease each season's cards in line to edge this rim of weathered pine, muster parades of cute pets and cartoons, jokes, flowery views, flutters of birds and flutes of wine and quills with pens. We face ourselves in a ring of colour, a passage of time in collage, a crown to frill heads, earmuffs and a trim of collar. You could not pass our threshold or pause for reflection in this room when it was bereft. No drum kit, PA, fiddle, coils of leads or shoes needing the warm-up of a dance. We do not complain. We are keeping well within walls we have lost the will to paint. Birthday wishes linger until we can deck the hall, gold, silver, red and green. Welcome flocks of doves and robins bringing messages, goodwill, love and hope for a bold new year. Thanks. Now, I have got another one. This is absolutely new. But I guess it's a bit sad. So perhaps not suitable for a birthday, but there you go. Maybe anything goes. Thanks. Poets find the right words sometimes. Unfettered by trees, fen and breezes blast the flat fields, whirl last season's leaves to circle the shelter of our lawn, cushion tinted rugs on the beds of bare shrubs. I can't hint at regrets when autumn cools blood, nips through skin. We always trust nature. Spring will surely come after the fall. Sadness presses my chest, the lack of breath budding like ill health. Brooding on a new death, I search for flowers, a shadow of hope. My eyes choose a card, the hand picks a pen and reaches for an envelope the size of sorrow. I know that aloneness, how it sucks the heat out of bone, burns the throat, turns on a pin. Obsessions freeze the minute, squeeze us dry. Poets find the right phrase sometimes. Try to spell out words for public empathy and balance private grief with universal truth. Other days we lose our touch with reality. Away with the fairies, my mother would say. Lost the air like that friend of a friend. Thank you. Thanks.
Fantastic, that was beautiful. Chris. Sorry. I've never heard you before, and I can see what Kizzy was saying. It's very calming, nice flow to your voice. And what you were saying was lovely.
Thank you. I have to tell my husband, though he does fall asleep when I start speaking to him. So.
Well, take it as a good thing in this case.
He's watching the football.
Oh, Gary, did you hear that?
It's okay. I've got a running commentary in my ear. Yeah, I just can't tell Kizzy because...
I know what the score is. I have goal alerts on my phone.
Have you got to know the score in the
background?
I have an idea what it is. I know who scored, but I don't know. Maybe by the look on your face, I don't know what the score is. Anyway, Chris, I haven't heard you do that last one, I don't think. And I'm really related to it in some way that I think we all must have as poets. Up next is our first feature of the night, the Haiku King, Generalismiso, Bryan Franco.
Yeah, Bryan.
Well, it turns out that my book, Everything I Think Is All in My Mind, this is the cover of the book turned on its side, has gone to the printer, and it should be arriving within the next week. It'll be available for sale, and when I have all that information out, I'll make sure everyone gets it. And I hope everyone buys a book from me because I could really use the money. But, you know, speaking of haikus, I have written 3 haikus for our 3 hosts. And even though I don't know you, Justar, I did do one for you because you have an interesting middleman. So first I'm going to do, well, I'm sorry, Gary, but I had to tell the truth about with this haiku, so bear with me. Where did I have this? Gary Hoskinson promised me apple crumble. I got burnt crumpets. This is for Kizzy. Professor Kizzy teaches us humanity with her poetry. And this is for you. Your middle name is Misdeamnour, which does scare the shite out of me. Okay, and so I have, Dane and I will be reading one of each other's poems, and I said, why don't I give you a poem, and you give me a poem, and we'll choose a poem for each other. This is the one that Dane chose for me, called Air So Heavy, Humid, Crystal Factory, Tiny Rainbows Everywhere, This Slender Kiss, The Chord of Fantasy, Death Blossoms, Tuesday. Played a barbecue, the poem, compact, dense strands woven, the ghost memory. I start this day sadly, stand in the corner, hope the painted floor dries. What are you doing to me? What I do to myself, I paste the socially acceptable sneer upon my sad, silent face, lighthouse to my secret misery. Perfect. For no help but to look at rose petal, liberation and the detail absolution. I am sufficiently high for all practical purposes. Practically, I asked and was told any answer is bound to be cellophane. Children, nightmare, orange skies that they now call dreams in their DNA. I am vaccinated. You, what did you do before the pandemic? You know that look people have. That when they are young, we had it before we mourned, saw the light last fading before the pandemic renaissance flew up into the ember's glowing night. I keep seeing the perfection denied me. Yes, I know I'm unworthy, but still the answer bleeds from the quill. This is rocks and throat words. I keep them in my full stomach, sleeping on my back. I hear them clack together, crumble, into stomach acid, lonely splinter stab. It is always my fault. I carry this black sack, light as lead floats on summer's breeze. I am located in that part of the world when light fails to eliminate anything but misery and unpaid bills, also known as Heavenville, Texas. I drink enough to think I can find some comfort here. I stand on the edge of cactus shadows at noon. I commune with rattlesnakes. I kiss on my sunburnt face. I watch the poor rodeo unfold. Eat barbecued beef under the Ramada. The beer garden accordion unfolds. The night under 700 stars. So long ago. And after I read this poem, I wrote this poem, which is called Another Cliche Has Painted Me into a Corner. Quote poet Dane Ince from his poem Ramada, I start this day sadly, stand in the corner, hope the painted floor dries. I once was commissioned to paint the floor of quite a large room. Over halfway through, I realized I was painting in the wrong direction. I had to literally paint myself into a corner. Then I had to wait for the paint to dry. Then I had to come back to paint the corner in a different color and sign my name. This is not a true story, or maybe it is. And the remainder of my set tonight will be from my book, which is called Everything I Think Is All in My Mind. The very first page is a series of haikus called A Slew of Haiku. And the last two have titles. So I'll just say one. The meaning of life is not about breathing, but deciding to breathe. Two, cynicism is an acquired attitude. No one is born that way. Three, optimism is more than just an idea. It can be a mantra. Four, embrace your crazy. Who you are is who you are. You are human. Five, figurative life vests for sale. When it rains and rains, my mind sends me to places perfect for joy. Six, the worms can't do all the work. Teach a man to fish, and he might not have patience to wait for a fish. The next poem is called Distressing. I feel distressed, or is it stress? Maybe I'm distressed because I'm stressed and possibly depressed, but I've been so depressed so much, sometimes I'm oblivious to the fact that I'm depressed, which is distressing and quite stressing and abnormally depressing, which I can only qualify as stressful and distressful and a little too full of anything I want anyway. This piece is called The Cover Man Cometh. I am a champion cyclist, not bicycles, emotions. I do it all, ups, downs, inside, outs, round and round, hills, valleys, twists, turns, loop-de-loops, and half pipes. I actually bore a hole through a solid granite mountain to create a shortcut. I used only once. Yes, I am a champion cyclist. My face has been on the cover of Psychology Today thrice. The three times I have won the Tour de France by simply riding out anxieties. Then my Liberty Bell cracked. Most people I know it has happened to say it happened to them sooner than it happened to me, and it happened to me quite late in life, so they say. Yes, they say, and they are the proverbial they. According to the woman who gave birth to me after 22 hours of labor, she doesn't recall it happening to me, or she doesn't want to admit she recalls it happening to me, so she says, and she is a proverbial she. Every adult's mother will always be a proverbial she. But I say, yes, I am the proverbial I say it happened when it happened. It happens to all types of people every day. When it happens to each person is at a point in their life called the present, not later, not sooner. So it happens when it happens. It can only happen when it's anyone's time for it to happen. It can happen to anyone at any time, which makes everyone a little bit the same as everyone else, as much as everyone is different from everyone else. Philosophy by Popeye the Sailor Man, or because I lost my birth certificate, doesn't mean I was never born. It's true. I'm certifiable, a fact undeniable, since I know myself better than anyone else. The source is reliable. Subversion therapy for me is not viable. So say what you want to say. I look in the mirror every day. What I always see is me. I am what I am, what I am. I was born this way. In fact, I can't change or rearrange. There are others like me on land and swimming the seas. They aren't afraid to be loud about being proud about whom they were born. Despite certain scorn, they walk tall and never fall from the words of others who, despite their druthers, will look in their mirrors each day only to see someone born that way. The world's greatest invention. My attention span is somewhat defective. My shrink says I don't look people in the eyes when I talk. Also, I purposely pretend to not listen when I listen. So when I say something, others won't be listening to what I say. It is as if that overly cushioned leather couch is a human-sized external disk drive wirelessly wired to his note-taking laptop so he can run a mental virus scan on me. The patent for that invention must be worth millions of dollars, maybe even billions. This is why I drive an hour and a half each way for a 50-minute appointment every other week. And I'm going to go ahead and this is called The Secret Surviving Sinkholes. Seemed to happen so organically. I decided to stay in bed more than 5 minutes, then 10 minutes, then an hour, and so on and so forth. Tears happened. For no discernible reason, out of the blue, without warning, without trigger, without help, I would have stayed in bed. This sudden sadness didn't just happen, it manifested. It was waiting in the wings to throw me the world's worst kind of surprise party. No people, no presents, no cake, but plenty of candles to burn down my life, my self-esteem, my sense of worth. Without help, I would have accepted the storyline the bed told me that it was the safest place for my existence. But a bed that talks is the voice of depression. Depression can seem like a cul-de-sac sinkhole that sucks in a car parked on the street, consumes a fire hydrant, takes a bite of sidewalk, then attacks a front yard, working its way up a walkway to the front door. It politely rings the doorbell before swallowing the door. A family of four and two dogs have to escape through the backyard, abandon everything they own, even cars, because the sinkhole expanded westward, engulfing the driveway. The inestimable speed of a sinkhole acts like depression when the word chemical is bandied about by a doctor. But no words used by doctors are bad words. Some words are just crutches, something temporary to the person who listens to their bed instead of their head starts recognizing the existence of their heart, their skin, their soul. Their peripheral vision is hampered by a hoodie the bed gave them as a gift at the surprise party that surprisingly never ended. But now, the owner of the bed has asked for help. I learned I can yell surprise at the bed, get up, walk away. And how much time do I have left, Kizzy?
I don't know. How much time did he have left, Gary? I don't...
I'm going to do this.
Five
minutes?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just scrolling through this book here. I'm trying to find the right piece. Bear with me. Why keep a midwife on speed dial? Anger does not always happen as screaming, yelling, stomping of feet, fist clenching, teeth gritting, furrowed brows, tattered nerves. Anger is not always born of aggression. It can be born of hurt and confusion from a womb unaware of the existence of its pregnancy, conceived via an act of deception or betrayal from a night of passion that materialized into a morning after that transformed into an insidious, compartmentalized ghost. Anger is not always loud. Anger can exist in silence and stagnation. Anger may not have hard edges that cut and bruise all who come in contact with it. It can be soft. It can be amorphous, made of quicksand, encompassing its host, suspended animation, causing phantom paralysis till whoever owns it realizes the phantom is a phantom, a figment of an emotion or feeling or a reaction to a life event or events that happened in the past. That is exactly what it is, the past, which can't exist in the present or future due to the fact that the past can only exist in the past. Then the anger starts to shed its skin to reveal a hollow inside that is a breath long held. Now exhaled and let go. Your smile never ceases to exist as part of who you are. Remember way back when your smile was your calling card? When you smiled for more than happy? When you smiled when you were embarrassed? When you smiled through a lie? When you liked to smile? When you used your teeth for more than chewing. Remember when you were always on, then you wanted to dim the lights a little. Attention felt like unattainable high expectations. Then you reverted back to wallflower. You were on vacation when you were present and no one knew but you. Silence was a place of comfort. Then you crossed the threshold when people started ending sentences and conversations with you with question marks that would never have had question marks in writing. Then you stopped going barefoot around family due to the myriad broken eggshells they left on the ground because it became mandatory to walk on eggshells around you. You felt hobbled by the unwritten rule that everyone else was allowed to stand up for themselves, but you must sit in the corner like Dennis the Menace as punishment for breathing. But when you breathed, you existed. Sometimes the act of existence is a form of standing up for yourself, even if you are unaware. Unwritten rules are unwritten and thusly incapable of being set in stone. The only things that are truly set in stone is that every human being is composed of blood, skin, and bones, and every single person decides how to use their teeth. One more, find the right one for you. I'll do this. It's called the cardiac surgeon who lives inside my psyche. I wish I could remove my heart into a satin-lined box every now and then. On the hottest summer nights, when it's too hot for a top sheet, when I have several fans strategically pointed at my bed, when I exist in a constant hot flash, on those nights, if I dare fall asleep, my dreams become a certain breed of warp. On those nights, the back of my neck sweats onto my pillow till I wake to flip the pillow. I sometimes wish I could remove my heart before certain family events so my brain can lean my reactions to the barrage of gaslighting I will endure and strategically sew my mouth shut for the sake of not making waves. I should never stand up for myself lest I be accused of shooting a semi-automatic military gun when I open my mouth. If I could remove my heart every time I run into someone who had targeted me for abuse in my past, I would place it on a plate, surgically slice a keloid scar from its edge, place it into a baby blue Tiffany & Company engagement ring box, stand atop a chair and declare to the recipient, "You gave this to me as if my future was wedded to your painful, obvious insensitivity and need to control, but you can't gift it because such car's owners must have a whole undamaged heart that has never known your warped vision of love. Apologies to Mariah Carey." Thank you, everyone.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, and everything in between is our first feature, Generalismiso, Bryan Franco, an amazing introspective set.
Woo, woo, woo!
Yay,
great
Bryan.
Set, Bryan, really, really good, really.
That brings us to the end of our first half. We will be back with a cinematic interlude for our second feature, Dane Ince, which is sent me and will probably go to plan, hopefully. It's just a toilet break, so it'll be a short one. We'll be back soon, but thank you everyone for being awesome.
Agree with that, and I was about to say I'm gonna play some background music to keep you boogie into the kettle or to the wine, prosecco, whatever you're on tonight. Water, it's all good for you. So how long are we gonna say, everyone? What are you saying, Kizzy?
I don't know, Gary's gone, so I suppose I've got to
Gary's eating more crumble.
Executive decision. So shall we say 5-7 minutes?
That's enough to fill up your tank. All right. It's not strict. We're not going to mark you late for school, but try and don't break the rules. Wait, I didn't even know it. All right, I'm going to play some background music. I'll try not to sing in the background because I might ruin the track. Here we go. Oh. Can you hear it? Let me do what I want to do. Play DJ for another 2 minutes. I think I've got a new job.
Your love has a force.
Right. Hopefully you should be back from the break. If you're not,
tune.
Birthday party vibes.
Tune. I just wanted to do. Just doing the
short version, but feel free to join in, sing along. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Pick and Mix.
Happy birthday, Pick and Mix. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
Oh, it's so quick. Okay, I reloaded. And then we're going to start in a second. Everyone is back and ready for the attack.
Okay.
Yeah, my name is Teresa Rose Deglementi.
Okay, hold on.
I'm calling because I'm
you're on the mic, Teresa.
Hold on. Teresa, let me mute. It's all right. Sorry about that, guys. It's all right. I got you. It's done. It's all right. Stevie Wonder always ends his tracks like that. My name's Teresa. Have you not heard them?
Oh.
Gary, how you doing? You all right? You had too much Apple Crumble?
Oh, I've just been hooey green. I felt ill all week, so we're all right.
Take it easy, Gary, man. We don't need you in hospital again, yo.
I know.
Someone tell him off, because I'll beat him
yeah,
up.
Yeah, Gary, have you got any, just have some hot water, black tea or something.
You have a nice little cup of tea, man.
Yeah, just black tea, no milk. Leave the milk out.
Tea fixes everything.
We got you, Gary. You need to take some rest. And that's what me and Justar are here for. So you need to turn your camera off and do so. Be well. We'd rather you be well than be here.
I've got a poem for you later. Don't come on camera. I'll read it out. It's going to be in my little Trini voice for you.
Anyway,
just relax.
I think we're all back, are we? So, and those that aren't, will catch up eventually. It's going to be a late night already, so we don't really want to make it too much later. Now on to our second feature. Poet and publisher, Dane Ince, he sent me a film that I am going to attempt to screen share for you. But tonight, anything to go by probably won't go great.
If we could, before you do that, I did have a outside of that, I did have Bryan had asked me to read one of his poems, and then I just completed a tribute poem to Gary that I'd like to ask your indulgence to read both of those before we start on the video.
Yeah, perfect. Well, while you're doing that, I'll start getting my tabs already so that you can't see my whole internet search history roller. Right.
Yeah, we don't want to see that.
All right. Okay. Thanks very much. I will do that then while you're doing the behind the scenes stuff. And I did also want to say that thank you to the host and to Gary. I'm very honored to be here with friends and share Bryan's work and share my work. I'm just very grateful Gary is a very important person to me and to our community as a whole. So thanks, Gary. From
tell him to look after. Sorry, just on that note, tell him to look after himself. We need you to be healthy, Gary. Stop stressing yourself out so much.
Yeah, Sorry. That's right. Stop it. Chill, man. From squirrel to eternity. I saw a squirrel with a pine cone in its mouth twice the size of its head. The squirrel had torn apart the pine cone, so it didn't look like a pine cone. It looked primal. But the squirrel was fluffy and cute, and I thought to myself that primal and cute never happened at the same time. I needed a picture. I walked around the corner, and the squirrel was just sitting there in the shade under a bush on a 92-degree Maine July afternoon. I lifted my camera for the photo. The squirrel dropped the pine cone into his paws and yelled, "Hey, motherfucker! I didn't give you permission to take my photo or take a film of me, make it a fucking meme, and your fucking human friends will fucking laugh and post it online." He put the cone in his mouth and he jetted fast and furiously, dodging and weaving a bevy of pine trees like a Heisman Trophy winner. He took shelter in a group of sculpted yews. I knew I'd never get the shot. I walked away. A pine cone that must have been flying 100 miles an hour hit the middle of my bald spot. As I lay in the grass, concussed and dizzy, the squirrel walked over to me and crossed his arms over his Ernest Borgnine From Here to Eternity barrel chest, looked me square in the eyes and said, "Take a photo of this, motherfucker." Thank you, Bryan. One of my favorites. Now, on to, oh, darn it, I've got this thing going on here. Here, let me get to it. It was in a different document. This is for Gary. Say my G, sweet like Humphrey and happy could be LSD tears pointed at the tip of the narrow bridge in Paul's enclosed mines. Get some crumble, get some applejack, put the sin so husky back in the sun, sunshine on Huskinson, the Stevie Wonder kiss puts the Peter in Petersboro. Say my Gary, he is a celebration, culture, dance step maker, call him hero, salute, a root toot toot, smooth, like fur-lined collar, velvet hat, smooth. Bends this into a shout to action loud enough to ring your bell on the pitch and on the pub. Connoisseur of crumble, king of righteous, winsome words, a master of the Tao. Say my Gary Huskinson, son is husk, a son, Gary, son, a song, a kiss, the mist, magic across the electron shocks our heart out of pandemic porridge, puddles, purple, the harmony puddles. We switched identity on a Zoom show, and we have not switched back, never will. The twist in the human chain cannot be unbound. The choir is singing, singing, saying it loudly. We are all one. Gary Huskinson, the kiss is on. There is not aversion. There is not fear. The mind, the soul, purple wrapped, felt, and sick, slick, sick, silk, supernova, beacon, hallelujah, Gary, abracadabra, Huskinson, this comes to be by your words, typically in the form of gibberish, but it now is because you say it so, knowledge of the arcane, knowledge of power, Huskinson, abracadabra, by this word we know the presence of virtual, say it this, Gary. Say this crumble for the revolution, incantation of how we could be. Thanks, Gary.
Crumble for the revolution. Yes, Dane. That is a tribute and a half. Gary, put your eyebrows back on and say something.
I just want to say Gary started it.
Thank you, Dane. Just talking to your mom again while I love you.
Because I give you such a hard time.
Tell me about it. Dane, thank you so much. Even my mom laughed and she doesn't like my poetry.
Cool.
That was an amazing tribute, Gary, and it included what he loves most, Apple Crumble. Do you just want this video playing from start to finish, Dane?
Is yeah, that yeah, right? Yeah, yeah, yeah. You can just start it and play it from start to finish.
Cool.
Just let you know, Dane, I've been in touch with Greta Thunberg, and she's now realised that in order to save climate change, the way to save it is give people crumble.
Right. Can you all see that?
Yeah.
Ramada.
Can you all hear that? Cool. Can I mute myself and you still hear that? Let's see.
Air so heavy, humid, a crystal factory, tiny rainbows everywhere. This slender kiss, the chord of fantasy, death blossoms Tuesday, the plate of barbecue, the poem compact, dense strands woven, the ghost memory. I start this day sadly, stand in the corner, hope the painted floor dries soon. What you are doing to me, what I do to myself. I paste the socially acceptable sneer upon my face, my sad, solemn face, lighthouse to my secret misery, perfect. Prefer no help but to look at rose petal, the liberation in detail, absolution. I am sufficiently high for all practical purposes, practically. I asked and was told the only answer is bound to be cellophane. The children nightmare orange skies that they now call dreams in their DNA. I'm vaccinated. You? What did you do before the pandemic? You know that look people have? They have it when they're young. We had it before we mourned, saw the light last fading, before the pandemic renaissance flew up into embers glowing night. I keep seeing the perfection denied me. Yes, I know I am unworthy, but still the answer bleeds from the quill. This is rocks in throat words. I keep them in my full stomach, sleeping on my back. I hear them clack together, crumble into stomach acid. Lonely splinters stab. It's always my fault. I carry this black sack, light as lead floats on summer breeze. I am located in a part of the world where light fails to illuminate anything but misery and unpaid bills, also known as Hebronville. I drink enough to think I can find some comfort here. I stand on the edge of cactus shadows at noon. I commune with rattlesnakes, a kiss on the cheek, on my sunburnt face. I watch the poor rodeo unfold, eat barbecued beef under the Ramada. The beer garden accordion unfolds the night under sapphire stars so long ago. It was yesterday. Golf. We talked on the phone 5 times. Then the time, fly, you died, you died, you died. I have the evidence. This picture when you were 3 and I am a babe in arms, black and white photo. The Buick must have been Geneva green, Verde green, green, green. But I keep reading as verdant green. On the river of calamity. You remember that time your dad pulled a gun and a can of mace on you? Well, it's like that. Only she used a bullwhip. been 20 years since she passed. I do not remember when amen or hallelujah collapsed from my mouth. Yes, my mother beat me. I was not close to her in the end. How could it I be so? When this biography is what is left after natural disaster, hurricane, loaf of muffalata bread went rock stale not more than 2 seconds after we crossed the border, where border is desert after being ocean, geology, this epic, somewhere in the mountains, somewhere in snow, somewhere in New Mexico. The dinner candle wax all burnt out, crumpled cotton napkins swatted, strewn about. I have forgiven all of that, or else how can I keep the unexamined china vase intact? Stage pot smudging voodoo bad spirits out, this adolescent feet dragging on limestone bottom, spring-fed Pecos River carries me away. I remember, I cannot easily remember your name, dead sister. I remember, I do not remember the pain. Under infinite blue Texas summer sky, nepenthe is surely what they meant. Floating down the river, watching stratocumulus or cumulus. Now is no time to remember all the names. These raindrops flow over the dams on the Rio Grande, out the Gulf of Mexico. Aria, nothing for nothingness. No thing helps. I have an ice cream scoop coming, a parcel in the post. I watch them pick radishes. I am left with no words unless tears verbalize diphthongs, rhymes with words like undulate, ripple, twist, the swan aria, melted lipstick, sidewalk, broken glass tattoo. Long ago, poets insist upon melancholy. The blossom, the thorn, the nexus. I am writing teenaged angst. They claim in Arkansas, it should be beautiful words about beautiful things, ideas, feelings, love. I wonder what is not beautiful in some certain light. The roll of waves, snakes and snakes coil, foam and hiss into sunset like that, like light fingers on thighs. Rising up to jackpot hot when heaven's choir harmonizes into sunrise light, the magma molten slow flow destruction, the first raindrops to land just before the gash in the thundercloud fully opens to bleed out, smolder onto hot dry sand, humid crunch under burnt bare feet. I am empty, nothing left to impart. But last wave retreats, the evidence petrified in sandstone. Santa Ana. Gray, unpainted clapboard house on Gould, ringworm on the next door kid's arm. We played the tableside jukebox song by some brand new band, all the rage, the smell of peeling wallpaper, the plaster wall. What comes through the AM radio static? Rocky, Rooster, Crow, Steve Stallion, Winnie's approval of the DJ's music selection. Tobacco juice stains on the side of the pickup truck, lost $300 somewhere on the top of the canyon. Overlooking the muddy, winding Rio Grande down below, the low summer shimmer heat, I nearly bought a condo in Brackettville. Empty, I, empty time, yesterday, now, cattle slaughter town, meat packers hangout, Northside beer bar, doughboy helmet hangs, a welcome in the window, owner's bed in pool, table felt green room in the back, just big enough for a bed. Parade by the courthouse, look out the window room, out the window room, look out the window, look out the waiting room window. Green and brown, the pumps pump out the slime. Little more than 7 decades come to this. Fishing on the lake, early morning promise in the water, west, west of dance hall casino, long burnt to the ground. You never taught me to swim. Later, learning too, as a Boy Scout, they pulled us out of the channel by the church, floating down the Pecos, rushed by bedrock, limestone, Big Ben hanging tree. I know about hankering for a lily. This is how I pass the time these days. Sleep on Gulf of Mexico sand. I know bugs eat balls of oil washing up on the shore. I slept through Galveston hurricane. I fish for bait shrimp off Padre Island. I have seen the marsh where Santa Ana surrendered. Bloody blood and muddy water. Long time tragedy still feeds the scavengers. Spring Street. The dull guillotine glints in surly smoke. The power of the state. Handcuffed, I cannot feel my cock. Just one blink last. I took the 56 Bel Air engine apart. Now rusty grease, silent scream, the flies out of the entropy. The flat at sunset, brilliant blue sleeping mountain, must be in Mexico. At the edge of black poking up, I stumble over gravel road home. All the things I find hold close are all the things I have lost. Nothing but a barbed wire fence between my crisp memory dungeon heart and north snow, frozen winds blowing south. TV antenna picking up a signal from Wyoming. Blankets are trailer house near the Rio Grande. Mystery unquestioned in kerosene lamp. I put my eye over microscope, looking for any way out. Out to escape in fat thundercloud, lightning, summer, future, rainstorm, humid, midday, desert, petrichor, sigh, salvation, visit sand candle makers in San Antonio, sitting in the dark in Del Rio, in Waco, in San Angelo, waiting for the picture to start, staring at the ceiling, faux night sky, royal blue, deep light sea, stars twinkle like endless tears. If I start crying now, I will never stop. Now I look at my wrinkled hands. They offer questions to render all now closed matchbook cover until potential of jackrabbit hops, thwang of broken guitar string, bourbon bottle leaking in the chest of drawers, eventually empty evermore. Upstairs on Spring Street. Without ceremony. Without ceremony, a shingle on a shack flaps, solitary wind song blows low and slow, lifts up and drops, one hand claps. Who should approve this without music? A dirge. What does this mean? Who told me pain would ease my time? Lamentation hymn I disregard in prison rhythm. Your sex and the color of your skin. The blossom petals fall upon the dark incantation of I am wrong. I am wrong. I alone am wrong. Fresh grave filled in dirt. The sadness of the shape. The imagination dies all and only in my head. The wound opens for the planting of seed. The scab of weeds is new life. Quiet, listen now to new whispers. Never wet. Someone close to me died. words would never wet the flame that consumed me on that pyre. I see what is left for me in this dust storm. I am naked under this smile. If Miss be wonderful, please do not do this in my name. Creak and clack, bleached bones, this canyon milk, I do recall to feel. That crumble white of ancient sea caliche, summer baked and sharp on tender feet. Running, I hunt at dusk, the country comes alive. I hand out death to rabbits so the family may eat. The gutting tradition haunts me. Oil slick memory slides on my tar ball heel. The sky is big. The pillows, clouds, proud, gather dark with a thirsty drop. Howl is a very good name for what it is not. Negative space. This all starts when trying to recall the color of crystal water and rocks and smooth. Autumn below, bridge under summer shady tree. The romance of longhorn cattle makes the armadillo laugh. Wind creek. When I fell, when the tip potential, the egg cracks scorpions into the perfectly seasoned cast iron pan regularly used for cornbread, when the promises sour milk. The screaming loud, I learned the lesson that cost you your life. What will I do when the plaintive cry of cat at my feet stop and go desert? This is now, no when. Solitary stealing, bargain for more. More than 6 years ago, I had no imagination of what yesterday would be. I live there for a minute. When tomorrow comes, I will not recall what was so important that I could not breathe. Why I did everything in my power to not live gently. Why myself is an angry twin, refuses to speak ignorant twin language to myself. When fruit salad spreads the rent money on number five, ignorant of useful as a rock star. Hold the door open with its weight. The fly sneaks through the small hole in the screen door. I went swimming in a muddle. When the summer sun smiling blisters, when me walks across the gravel road like the gravel road used to be baked dry, sunburnt ejaculation yellow, pick the best peach tree switch. When the mud puddle was special and warm, I will keep the meaning of the rule of three secret for now. It would just spoil the ending when you won't accept the beginning. I carry this unending wound. Ocean in my imaginary Texas. Choose sweet mesquite, beans, cactus, blossom, thorns. Stick my memory, dust devils flat and holy, the perfect shape smoking over drapes. Over cedar fence post, mistake of swallowing tobacco juice instead of spitting, swimming in west, crystal spring water, clear San Felipe Creek. When hop, my perfect wonder amazes me with more questions. I pick them like ripe peaches, eat them juicy and raw, perfectly sweetly. Juice drops everywhere, bloody summer sunburn, the empty aching midnight at noon, opus on blackness filling the room, sizzle of bare feet on sidewalk, beer bottle, broken glass, asphalt, lone star or Schlitz. Hopping to hop like a lion's bloody muzzle, a riot, a dreary visit to the scene of the crime. Wonder about the edges of the whole of you. Do you slice your fingers on it still when you run your pinky and thumbs along its edge to assure still there? Sharpest cutting dull, beware, or has it been long enough that the sharp edges roll over like a dulled kitchen knife, resting head on shoulder, listening to heartbeat, listening to love, or an embarrassing long, long time, as long as it takes to smell every smell of grass in an afternoon summer dream of a nap. Wednesday, journal. The cat ripped my jaw open, snowflakes fell out. How could I not? Ocean Beach, Maryland, drink the liquid detritus from the bottom malachite gefilte fish jar. I crawl at the bottom. Tisk, 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 the hooligan vernacular. I eat you like late summer overripe sticky juice runs down, do not care, Texas tanned belly, sticky pistol tickled, delicate hairy bee legs vibrate, rubs the spilling pollen pushing out, watch the empty bottle spin on the bar, it keeps ending to pointing at no one but the ghost. The mare, separated from her stallion Phoenix, reunited after a couple of years of unbearable pecking of lonely crows. Wild horses gallop away. I wonder if that is what people call happy. I cough dust, solo hombre, caliche cutting bare feet, bird sings to rattlesnakes rattling under cactus desert forest, shading only the dead. Ocean gone half past the paleontologist's ass, whisper of horse love stories. Can you stop this wind, the seasonal snow falling cold to change the happy, the fatal car wreck? The journal entry after the horror Wednesday, vacant domestic violence to some of the righteous path, deadly temper tantrum tornado, trapped hormonal adolescent in fat grown men minds, the victim victimizes themselves and sings hallelujah like an anthem. They never knew the words to, just like they got God's good work done. Oh, so proud of the tiny pretzel they see below the jelly roll. They are miserable. They love misery. They will spread the misery to all and dumbly say, see, I told you so. The prison affirmation gives them joy. They understand barely what was modeled for them. They certainly cannot apply the lessons. They are afraid. They want us all to live in their conception of their safe and considered hell. Your freedom is a challenge to what they feel is safe. There is no way they could appreciate, nor should they need to. But what of me? I put into this world this idea, made baby this idea being born, it may live beyond all. My blood on the sidewalk is no phosphine illusion, red liver riven rolling out to the sleep, sleep warmly in the salty sea. This alabaster history smooth excerpt, the jagged edges left marauded, criminally exhaled, dream of sex now, the sweet sweat, tits on tits, clits on clits, rubbing till fire flames extinguish cloud vapors, this ghost, Shogun, sitting in the room with genius. Do you bow, mop your brow? Cotton dish towel to you, like you did on Collins Street where you caught crawdads. Do you know the word for sorrow, sorrow, sorrow? Watch blue jays, black oak forest, sat on bentwood willow settee, shaded by black oak tree, Texas dirt road down to where the Ridgeway girls lived. watching the old man dip snuff snuck into his clapboard house, painted yellow devil's horns on the unfinished portrait. Sycamore grew tall. Your cousin dated the neighbor girl. This is where the writing starts. Leaking on the page, swab for any clue, fingerprint data, DNA. Holler down the bomb shelter hallway, factor 30 on. Ready, wrecking ball ready. Can I eat it? Can I fuck it? Can I die if I do or don't? Red, that brick red. Under English summer, blue sky, clouds simmer, soft kisses on bruised love lips.
Amazing film.
Amazing stuff, guys.
That was just amazing. Fantastic, Dane. Fantastic.
Speechless.
I don't think I was breathing for most of that.
It was beautiful.
I thought it was really interesting how you connected the poems. The individual poems together to make that narrative. That was really cool. I'll pass on to my capable co-host, Justar, to announce the next act.
Well, thank you, my lovely Kizzy. Yeah, that was lovely. That was very like trans-like. Like I was in the zone. Is it Tish or Tish? I don't know how I say your name. Sorry.
It's Tish.
Tish. I know, because I know someone else, and we call her Tish, and spoke the same. So apologies, but the stage is yours.
I don't really know how to read after that. And
I think what we can do, Tish, is just another round of applause for Dane. And,
yes, think, please. Yeah. Yeah, let's, all, please. Sure.
I think we're all in transit at the moment.
Yeah.
And it's
fantastic.
Amazing.
Yeah. It was like following Kathy Carson with Andrex.
I
want to cry.
I'm very proud of you, Dane. Dane's my partner, for those that don't know. Transatlantic love.
He is now going to make some money.
And just really proud of you, your Texan love and grief. Really, really proud. I'm going to do two poems. So for those that don't know me, my name's Tish Camp. I'm a Trinidadian Irish poet from London, living in Gloucestershire in Tewkesbury now. Started doing Greek poetry after my husband died in 2017. Three of my sisters, my mother and father. So I kind of do a lot of that, but I also do a lot of feminist and political poetry as well. So this is one called Where Are Your Masks? This was written recently. Paper masks drip down faces, in breathe you, eat you, swallows. The people slip down gel on each gargled garland of another's vapor. Fluoride inside, foaming away, peanut butter caves. Egalitarian elevators empty, coasting glass factories. People shift people into boxes. The small swallows we made, yellow river of tears. Juggernauts jackknife into thrones of tinned ham. Black ink, squid game, tripping triangles in mirrors relay, swipe up, down of festival lights, play with dust, circles finger, ribbon shredded, dead heads, type or cast, wearing masks, theatres of silicone screen, large scapes of velvet, green bodice and bustle, hustle in crowds, aroused, loud, fixed and vexed, genetical, heretical, double vaxxed, blessed. Where are your masks? Did you leave them at home? Do you know the tyranny? Can you speak the unspeakable? Thank you. This next one is called Honey in My Coffee. This is for my father, my late father. I put honey in my coffee. A teaspoon is enough, swirling black in metal whirlpools, mesmerized, falling into wet holes, down, down, down. Reach for sugar, I return, putting back to shelf, faults, reminisce on this, father advice, kettle click, hot water into cup. Stood next to him, I am there listening, in his kitchen, he makes bakes in an oven, 5 a.m. I am both woman and child, early rise, we are quiet, alone together, like the 1970s earache, shipping forecast radio, we're quiet by fireside, warm oil buds in ear, alone time together, both listening, we take in being, silence, other, back to my kitchen, woman child, remembering. Thank you. And this last one, I'm going to try and... This is a poem for Gary.
Whoa, hold on. You just dive into them too quickly. Give it a minute. Like, let everyone just waltz on. Right. Like, you know? I think, I don't know, it's not my event, but, you know, I'm co-host, so I've got the mic. Basically, I feel like sometimes you have a poem and you have a little whoa. Anyone want to say anything? Anyone want to digest that? You
know? Okay.
And then bam, bam, bam. And plus you said bakes. And my family Guyanese, yeah. No one knows about bakes. They say the dumplings. No, they're bakes, brethren. Like, bakes.
Right.
Yeah. So I just wanted to pick up that as well because you never hear bakes. Like,
thank you, sister. Thank you for that. All right, sorry. So this one, my first poem that I did, a performance poem, poetry, was called As a Trini Gyal. And Gary likes that one. So this is another one in that tongue called Egistink So. And this is about the government. This is for Gary and also for Hannah today and myself with my universal credit claim that went pear-shaped. Okay. Corruption, like it's straying from fashion. I got nowhere to fast. When people take time and watch, corrupt me one throw down, crack egg in pan. Too fast, cha government stinks so. Rotten roost, hen click, scratching a seed slow. I waggle overthrow. Eggy stink so, you have to throw that out. Corruption, take arm and politician know that egg soon come, him dodge and slip from people scratching up that shit. Rotten government, me say you're too fast. You watch me cook egg today. Thank you.
Yes.
A bit politic. And that's for Gary, because I know he loves you when I do that stuff. Bless you.
I love the way you mixed it up. That was vibes.
Bless you. Thank you.
Yeah, I love that, mate. Loved it.
What are you saying, Gary?
I was gonna sort of mention that Justar is a poet as well, and yes, she's a poet, a wordsmith, when you can get a word in edgeways.
Touché.
She's the queen. If you want to find her, she's always on Instagram. She's the sort of lady what wakes up in the afternoon and said, who wants to do an Insta Live jam? And that's... So... It's a pleasure for me just mixing people up from like introducing Justin to Trish, and like, yeah, I'm overwhelmed tonight. I see people coming in and out because Marissa Prada just jumped in, then she jumped out because she's got her own thing. But I'll back over to you, Justin.
That's good. People got love for you, Gary, as you know. It's nice to see. I'm going to jump in.
I will say, Justin sticks up for me so that anybody disses me. You get the walls of Jericho following you. A couple of months ago, a certain person, don't mention their name, because people started dissing me online. Well, the walls of Jericho have come down.
Don't run with McGarry. Don't run with McGarry. All right. By the way, I make t-shirts that say I do art in it, and we work with the artist in it. It's my brand. Don't know if you know, it's my cup. Let me do a little plug quickly.
I do art in it. I do art in it, basically. Gary knows I do a bit of everything. I'm working on a project that's going in Versace next month.
And just does all my posters for sale.
Wow. Did she just say Versace?
Yes.
Yes, sister. Right, let's just give it a round of applause for that. That's fantastic.
It's not a bad way to end the year, the whole of December, the 1st of December. It's right here. I can't show you. I'm not going to lie because it's like, no, pops.
Just like there's all my logos. Bye, Jeff.
Bye.
Thank you, Jeff, so much. She does all my logos. She does. I don't give her much notice, about half a day.
Less than that. You ask it like the day after it's happened.
Yeah. Almost, if you look at the Stephen Lawrence pictures and
classic glory
and the George Floyd, she did them all.
Oh, right, yeah, the paintings are down here. I'm waiting for you to collect them.
All right, let's get this show on the road.
Right, Kizzy, you want to take over?
I believe it's one of your friends next.
Is Nelsa in the building? I don't think Nelsa's in the building.
No, she's not.
She's not.
Oh, in that case. We are on to, let me check, Wallace, Plant and Carrier, who
are... He's gone. He's joined Marissa.
Seems to... Marissa's
here. Just come back. She's gone again.
She's coming.
She's back.
I'm looking. Back. What about Hill. And Leslie, and Chancellor, Teresa, and...
If you want to go to Hill now, we can, but I thought on the list you said she was meant to close it, but...
No, it's not to Hill. I'm so pleased she's here. If Marissa wants to do one of the X-rated poems, I'll just go and make sure my mum's got her earmuffs on.
May I give an opinion? I would really like to hear Hill because she has been my favourite. She has just been doing so well that it's hard for me. The anticipation is worse than a ketchup bottle that won't empty out when I see Hill in there. I need my dose of Hill right now.
Yeah, we need a Hill pill.
People have spoken.
So I'll leave it to you guys. We've got Hill, we've got the insightful Leslie and Marissa with something. What's not
that sounds like
heart.
The order then, let's go, that sounds like the order. Hill, the people have spoken.
Well, thank you, I feel so loved. So actually I was gonna read like a short poem and a longer poem, but I couldn't find the short one I wanted, so I wrote a new one on my phone on the toilet during the break, so I make no promises about quality, but this is a new poem no one has heard yet, so here we go. You and I. You're supposed to be sad, you remind me every once in a while. You're supposed to be broken, lonely, forgotten, unforgiven, teetering on the brink. You, victim, survivor, orphan, jobless, loverless, autistic, borderline, traumatized, so many years past your junkyard body's expiration date, are supposed to drown in your tears and wash the slate clean with salt water. But I, in response, only wipe my tears with your expectations, turn them into a crumpled tissue in the trash, lace up my docks with trembling hands, head out for another walk, scream out my pain, anger, loss, desperation, fear, hunger, exhaustion at the microphone once in a while, then sit at the table with my dice and my dreams and drown you out with a laugh that doesn't need your permission to exist. So that's the new one.
Wow. That was hot. That was hot.
Thank you.
So you wrote it on the toilet?
I did, like during the break, just a few minutes ago.
So that's your shit poetry.
Yes, that's my shit poetry. Yeah.
Oh, you know what?
I want to see a good poetry then, because that was some good shit.
I finally met someone whose shit don't stink.
I've so missed you, Hill.
I've missed you too. I was so glad that you messaged me, and I actually like canceled two other things to be here today. I was so determined.
Oh, honestly, it was my best thing about 2 o'clock on a Sunday morning in there. But honestly, I miss you loads.
Thank you so much. I will read one more poem, and it's kind of longer, and it's called Sexy Disaster Queers. I know that we want some better representation, and I know that we need the world to believe that we can be anyone. Your neighbor, your doctor, your congressperson, or your mother-in-law. But look, look, there's a part of me that perks up at the unashamed wrecking ball that is a good disaster queer, at the half-dressed, half-cocked hurricane that spins through the lives of every character with an energy and a charisma uniquely created by the rejection of every expectation from every side. I know that it would be nice to live in the same house for a very long time and have a real career and maybe even someone to put down as my emergency contact. But look, look, these rainbow pants make my ass look glorious. And there is no substitute for the rock star confidence boost of undercuts and wild colors, the fabulous freedom of connecting and releasing the energy of conversations with strangers, flippant flirtations that lead nowhere, and jokes for whom the in-group is a fluctuating fluid family of the moment. I know that each day there are men who look in my direction with longing, who want to label me woman and prefix it with mine, and that society would breathe a sigh of relief. But look, look, I want to be sexy disaster queers with you, want to lounge around in our boxers and feast our eyes on every glitter bombed washout with just the right saunter, want to trade kisses in between secrets about our latest real life crushes. We might just be tempted to take a night off to woo. Want to retrieve that unicorn hoodie from the floor drove and slide it on and turn my head to catch the scent of you. Want to cook breakfast or dinner, Brenner? At midnight, halfway through a bottle of wine, dance terribly as songs that remind us of our favorite ships or our most nostalgic exes. Want to spin around in a skirt and look smug when you tell me you're looking handsome, sir. Want to live my whole life as the only moderately grown-up version of the child who chucked respectability politics out the window the first time someone used them to strangle a genuine life beneath a rug or starve a spirit with a color scheme. I know, that we're supposed to want so many other things. And I'll send my genuine congratulations to every successful friend or lover who breaks some cycle or other. But listen, just once in a while, I think, I want to be sexy disaster queers with someone who can look into my eyes, see every trauma that I breathe through, and still laugh along. Thank you.
Whoa.
Yes.
I love that.
Oh my God, Hill, I love that. Yes, yes, yes.
Brilliant, yes. Brilliant. Dane, right. you must get Hill to feature at Time to Arrive.
Fantastic. Did that once.
You guys are way behind the eight ball.
I did that once.
In September.
Oh my God, I'm sorry. I need to come again. Get back on again.
Hill. Oh yeah, of course. Yes, Hill. Come back.
Hill, it's official. I am coming to Nashville, which is about 40 miles away from you. I know. I'm coming in there in the summer. It's got to be after the football season. But I can't come in October because of the World Cup that time. And next so. I'm coming. They might, you know, probably on the most wanted list. I don't care. I'm so coming.
I'm glad. Yes.
I'm going to meet you at the crossroads. I'm going to
perfect.
I'm going to meet you at the mall. I'm going to everywhere.
I love that poem almost as much as I love your T-shirt. I think that is a great T-shirt. I think we
Thank
need
you.
More of those T-shirts. Anyway, before we get too sidetracked by sexy disaster queers, I think we have someone else that wants to do something sexier. I don't know. According to Gary, we're looking for some X-rated stuff from Marissa.
You decide which rank. We've got the insatiable Leslie and anyone else.
Put Leslie on for sure. If you decide you want me to read, let me know.
I want you to read, Marissa. I've just had a circumcision, so it might help.
I feel bad though. If Kizzy's still, you're still a minor though.
I feel like I'm responsible when I read this.
But also, I wish someone would have told me some of this shit when I was young.
I know what to expect.
I don't know. This new poem, I'll read this new one if you give me your consent, Kizzy.
How old are you, Kizzy?
17.
Right, so she's past the age of consent in the UK, and the Gaelic competency test means that she knows what to do when she's doing it. Is that right?
All right. Be careful. Miss Gaelic lives near me, and Chris is there. Yeah.
All right, leave my co-host alone.
Yeah. Love take it away, girl. From Leslie. Love to hear something from Leslie, too. But you guys are running it. You're crashing the ship right into the...
I'd really like to finish on Leslie, because Leslie's another human being that really chilled me out, and I feel like after Marissa, I'm going to need... Leslie is the antidote.
Sounds like a good idea.
Go ahead, Marissa.
Oh, so you want me to go before Leslie? Are you sure you want that? I don't think you want that.
She wants Leslie to tame us back down afterwards.
Oh, okay, good. All right, okay. I'm all right. Oh my gosh. I'm so sorry, Leslie. Oh my God. Tish, this is for you. Dick me down. Dick me up. Dick me all the way into next Sunday when God is listening. And I can ask for another chance to get dicked down all over again. Dick me up. Dick me down, dick me all the way sideways, smile screaming more than fuck. I didn't know about that spot. Rub your dick on every inch of my skin. Make me so sticky, I cling to sheets, unable to move as you fuck me all the way into next Sunday when God is listening. When my knees are crying, pussy weeping, sitting, challenging even on those long gray cushions. Thinking of your dick, my lips, pussy, lips fucked raw, you rake of a man, my hands on the take of your offering plate as I sat on your face, you swallow so well. Shift my ass cheeks beneath me, still red, still there. I lick my lips, remember your tip. Swallow. Remember your shaft, the back of my throat, choke, gag, breathe. My mind, a creative being, used to being naughty, knots of nose submitted to yes. Please feed me, for I am crazy for the chef. Feed my soul, feed yourself me. I am yours for the take out. I want you as my take out. I want to take you all the way in, starving so hard that everything tastes necessary. Feast so hard, next thing I see, rise and shine, DoorDash lines, Uber eats pussy clean, make out like bandits, dinner sinners among saints, take me to your dessert, dick, whipped cream dream of wreck me, sexy man, inglorious mind, creative flecks of cum mixed with sour to keep it interesting.
Agre dulce, be dulce sweet on my tongue, your tongue, our tongue. We can sin as much as you want or need. Kneading me into your loaf, plait me, bend me, braid me into your locks so we become the twine that ties the chimes of these rhymes at dinner time. Eat me, feast on me. Prepare me to course through you. Meals on wheels, let's fuck in the car. Let's fuck on a bus, let's fuck on a plane and a train and motorboat my titties. Some like it hot, hot toddies for days. There is no escape, I got this room all night long and paid the damage deposit. When we emerge, I want days to have passed us by. We be like wild creatures emerging from hibernation, sore, chafed bodies, nothing else to break, desperate to fuck all over again. Maybe we can make it to the elevator, maybe even the lobby or your car again. Not to an actual restaurant though, cause I could eat you all day and night. Your cum, all the nutrients I need till your dick quits, falls off, taps out, power through taps playing in the background. Grape nuts, take your nuts, fiber adds years to my life, heart health, lifestyles of the rich and fucked so good by your dick before I kill it. Don't worry, Poppy. I will suck it the fuck back to life. Checkouts, not till noon. Thank you.
Oh my lord.
Wow. I think you should take the lead on the 100.
Oh, okay, now I take it back. Kizzy, you should have covered your ears. All right, I hope you weren't listening. Okay. All right.
This is probably I would rate this like a 7 maybe on what I do. It's on the higher
just playing out like little headshot that I have with just so like my grandma likes Carrie's videos.
But it made me laugh. If I looked like I was laughing in between your poem, it was because Kizzy made me laugh. She's like, I can't share this on Facebook. My grandma watches Gary's videos.
Oh my lord. I'm sorry, Leslie. Sorry, not sorry, but
don't apologize for doing you. Well, doing everybody, doing somebody.
Just doing myself these days.
I love it how you always like make her a beeline for saying, oh, this is for Tish, like, I'm the big sex woman here. Because Leslie was like, oh, yeah.
It's for Gary, he would lose his shit, right? Like,
I think poetry has made me more mature about that stuff.
Yeah.
Because, like, the amount of people at just random events that do things like that, it's weird. And the first couple of times I was like, what's going on? And now I just ignore it.
Just close your ears and look the other way.
And it's good to, you know, being a young woman, it's good to be with other women who are sex positive in a safe way and can teach you how to be safe and how to own your power and not give it so freely away. I wish I knew a lot of what I know now when I was younger, like more your age and like my 20s too.
Yeah, I'm very sex positive. I used to be a sexual health worker in gun clinic. I used to run lesbian and bisexual young women's projects and young youth centers, give out condoms and lube and whatnot, and lots of advice on safety with not just with sex but within relationships as well. But yeah, sex positive, it's safe, so and fun and all that.
Thank you all for indulging my shenanigans.
I don't think Jane's in the room. So do we want to go straight to Leslie? Because I don't know. I can see Jane.
Yeah, let's go to Leslie to make things more even now. So that I don't want to send you to bed with any nightmares.
It's clocked, Hill's message in the chat. I'm like, yep, you're in the club, Hill.
Marissa, you missed my poem about my circumcision, but It just seems completely pointless now.
Sorry, I missed it, Gary. I'll need a private showing of that one.
Before we go to Leslie, can I just say thank you, a mega thanks to my two wing, my wing people. I don't go anywhere without either Kizzy or Justar. It's just whatever event it is, Kizzy going, am I coming to this? And I go, yeah. And I get a call from Justar, Gary, what's happening, you old man? And I go, okay. So I have a big cavity of apples for my two wingmen, wing people.
We have to give you sick, Gary, but we love you and we want you to chill because we'd rather you be well than be active. We want you to chill and be like, yeah.
I've never been event. Just to let you know, I've been every time I took my video, I've been spooning up in the toilet but laughing at the same time. So it's like, hey, he's just one of those.
And I need to thank you personally because this is also my year anniversary of being involved in any of your projects.
And you're moving closer, nearer to me with a better look, so that bit.
Hopefully, if I get my first choice uni.
Yeah, but no, I'd just like to thank you both. I'll quickly, there's a picture of me and Kizzy when we first actually met in real life back in September. That one there.
That was one of the best days, I mean. And that photo took me really by surprise.
It's one of the best, literally one of the best days of my life because Kizzy come from York, which is a good, that's right up north compared to where Peter is. And
you know, you're on my personal statement, right?
And it was just one of the best days when this young girl comes up to me in this midfield. So, you know you're special to me, Kizzy. even though you're a gobby cow.
And me, you and Quinton adopted a kid that day.
My name for Kizzy is Greta Thunberg on acid, so she is. All right, I'll leave it to you two. I'm going to
close it out. Leslie Constable.
Hi everyone. What an evening. I'm all for celebrating the terrible twos. Anyhow, all right, so I'm going to read two, and I'm just going to read this one because I am. And then I'm going to read another one that is my homage to a sex poem. So that's what I'm going to end with. It's as good as it gets for me. So this one is, it's
Kizzy,
called
You Can't Escape Him.
That Witch is Behind the Curtain. Stage defenseless, the curtains argue with you to stay closed, their weight gathered in the folds, the cue to open unheeded. This fragile barrier that shields you from the gaze, the shame of showing yourself all eyes upon you when the curtains open and gasping mouths reveal you naked, unprepared for this heated gaze, the eyes trained surveying this mortal frame that holds you raw. You are not that which is seen. The wise inner body knows, and you are this, the hidden one, this other masked by the breathing of pure light, the beacon unseen, heavy amulets, the crystals you wear slipped over your head, weighted, hanging so long as to anchor you, ensnare you. Wrapped exquisite around you and drag across the floor, there is no blood from the thorns, only the thick treacle, this something which will well up and will in time exude from your pores in time and time, 20 years. This pool, so sweet, you're called, so sweet. Never a sharp word, never a sharp word. Barbs from the outside hidden to harm the inside of you who never strikes. The you who never strikes, though you could, though you want to, but repel another you. You are so sweet with dark circle dyes and a tumor grown quietly unheard in the dark places of wounds. If I am so sweet, then eat and be done, and then go to the next one you find sweet and ready to eat, and I will go elsewhere. So that's that one.
Whoa, Leslie, yes.
So beautiful the way you speak too, Socha.
So this one is called Minotaur, and I'm a real Picasso fan. I'm like an incredible Picasso fan, and oddly or not, when I was born, my parents, who were total leftist bohemians back in the 50s, had placed Picasso prints all over my little room, and it placed one beside my crib. And I sort of remember, but it was sort of my reality. I sort of got to understand what was going on with Picasso. So this one, I love his Minotaur. I don't know if other people are Picasso fans, but the Minotaur represents this very raw and powerful sexuality. So it's called the Minotaur. I lick the naked sand from your feet like sugar. Still, I want more. The insects flying in the air above, stinging you, hurt only if you mind them. And then only briefly, only for the moment you enter. It was I who wanted you that dark night, whispering. I in my satin and rustling petticoats laughing, and all the small bells strung along my waist, knotted in my hair, laced to wrist and ankle, chiming. It was I who wanted you, coaxing, laughing. Come, I said, come with me, come. If you take me down, I will go, you know this. There will be no struggle, so why put me over your back, my hair hanging down and into yours, tangled, impossible, and me laughing? You don't laugh. Why not laugh? We're in the desert at night. The sand of ghost ocean spreads forever and crosses down into Sonora, across and through and into the Holy Mother of the hunted ones, the shapeshifters. I see them all moving in the night. Iguanas sleep in trees with the moon full above and blink still and see everything and see nothing with their eyes closed and the dream of the world to come. If I could sleep, I would feel the moon on my skin bathing me through the window and turning me pure white like liquid, and I wash myself like a cat, licking candy bar feet, you suck my toes, licking the sand away like sugar sticking to my skin, sticking to your skin, washes away our sins, licking our ankles sweetly like sugar, with every step I am sucked down. It is her body we walk on, our mother, the desert, as you carry me over the night sands, and I am giggly like a schoolgirl, bells tangled in my hair, over my waist, on wrist and ankle, chiming, jingling with each step, and you want me, and I you. But it is more than that. It is always more. One day we will sleep together and not wake up. You know this. I am asleep as I am awake, and I stare at the moon, the bougainvilleas curling up the gates to infinity, the swifts dart and circle churning the night air, and I ask, as all women do, of the moon, but why this, of all things possible, and what does it mean, this? And I hear you laughing. You are laughing because you know that I know already and am content, and I never knew you until now. But you know this, and you are content. So that's it for me.
Woo! Woo!
You're such a beautiful, amazing poet, Leslie. Oh,
Dane needs to do a movie of that poem, I think. He needs to get Dane to get the visuals and the music together.
I think she's got it covered. That was terrific. But yeah, thanks, Leslie. Thanks, Bryan.
Also, talented people. I'm humbled to that. In fact, I'm humbled to call you all my friends. I really am.
Bye. I'll be Shadis' Gary's event and he'll have the last word as usual. But I know I want to say, and I'm sure just like you want to say Nick, thank you everyone for coming, and bits have been kind of touch and go at times, but I hope you've laughed at us and with us.
Hey, Kizzy, do you want to see Generalismiso's book? It just arrived. Do you guys want to see? I haven't even seen it yet. You guys want to see it for the first time?
Can we have a drum roll, please?
Yay. Bryan, are you here so you can look
Bryan,
at
Bryan, can you take your... Yeah.
Take a bow.
Yeah, we need to see you.
I feel like this should be, like, lower.
Is it one book or ten? That's a lot of packaging.
All right. This is the book by Generalismiso Bryan Franco, Everything I Think Is All In My Mind. Ta-da!
Boom!
There it is!
Oh, it's your background!
Woo-hoo. It's a real whole book! And look, there's his cute face. Look at his adorable face right there on the back. There's your book, my friend!
Wow.
Oh,
wow. Wow. Excellent. Wow. Yours, well, congratulations.
Go on to everybody.
Whole huge book. Please go buy his book. Get the pre-orders. I'm sure he has something set up for pre-orders, but I got your book, G, so I'll get it in the mail as soon as I can, okay?
Thank you. I love you.
You're welcome. I didn't want to open it without
you. You're supposed
to
say, Bryan, I love you too, but just as a friend.
Bryan, I love you too.
Bryan. Yours will go on the never-ending list, an evergreen list of friends' books that I must eventually purchase.
I can't say how much money I have spent during the pandemic on poetry books, and I actually have read them, which usually when I buy poetry books, I sort of start reading them but don't finish them, but I've actually finished most of the poetry books that I bought from everyone.
Now you can book swap, though, too.
Right, yes, so I have been discussing with my other next 10 people about that, yes.
There's at least like three of you in this room that I promised to buy your book at some point, and I will buy your book at some point, but I don't
I want to tell everyone.
Kizzy, I might have the answer to your prayers, because I'm buying two copies of everybody's book, one for me to keep, but I'm collecting lots of books in March the 8th, it's International Women's Day, and we'll be doing something like we did last year, but bigger. And
wow, that sounds great.
And what I'm doing is, what we do, I'm buying everybody's books for comparison, but I'm gonna raffle all the books off, and the money goes to Sister Space, a domestic abuse charity. So that. You will see it, because I'll be like on your news feed, but that's, I'm buying two copies of every book, one for me. If I don't like it, I've got two books in the raffle.
We absolutely bossed National Women's Day last year.
I know we did. I took so much stick from women and blokes for booking it on, but this year, Kizzy, you're coming to Peterborough, so are you, Leslie. Here we have to get your visa sorted, but we'll work on it.
Maybe I'll make it there before the end of the year.
Yeah. So, but I've got Peterborough Museum.
Next year, I might be actually living within like half an hour of you.
Yeah, I know. I've spoken to the local police. Justar, you're going to be there in March as well. Natalie, I'm going to have to send somebody out to Finland to come and get you. It's going to be the biggest Women's Day that there is.
Gary, do you know yet that this year on the Women's Day with D was my first thing, but you know March the 9th is my birthday, so like it's like the way the International Women's Day, and then that's
yeah, National Women's Day is 8th. I'm doing 2 weeks of it because March 15th is Mother's Day.
Yeah, that.
Yeah, mate, I've got a British passport, so any chance I get.
You're coming on, honestly, just don't book anything, Joey. Speak to your partner. Tell him, Mickey, I don't know, whatever he does in Finland, he can do that. You're coming over here. I'm coming over to Gloucester before Christmas anyway.
Yeah, come over. I'm going to make you a big crumble. Just me and you, big tub of two-litre ice cream to go with it, yeah?
You get on the other end of the table. Two big spoons for the World Cup. So
I'm going to have to go. I want to say thank you so much for a fantastic, fantastic event this evening. Happy birthday to Pick and Mix, to the two wonderful features here tonight. The sidekicks that you got there, he's Justar and Kizzy. We did a wonderful job as well, Gary. Absolutely fantastic. And for anyone that wants to get any support with their books as well, I know there's publishers here. We've got Dane Ince with I Publish You and Marissa Prada with Red Agree Books. Or anybody else that wants any help. I know Justar's doing some marketing now, just heard tonight. So maybe Justar and me, Tish Social, I'm on the chat, save the chat. Or hashtag Tish Social to look up for that.
We're in a book that comes out before Christmas, aren't we?
We are indeed. It's coming up real, real soon.
In a lockdown, and apparently I'm going to be in a calendar as well. So hey,
oh good, oh Lord have mercy, I'm going to have to delete 1 month for that calendar.
Hook me up then, and I'll sort out the marketing with you. All right, bless you guys. I'm going to say and leave you.
Right, good night.
Good night.
I love you all. When I grow up, I want to be all of you.
Happy birthday.
Hi, Gary. Bye, everyone.
Are you ever sorry? Everyone. I've just been falling away as well. I've not been on my game, so I'm really sorry.
Hey, excellent hosting, guys.
Thanks, everybody.
Brilliant back announcing, Kizzy. Well done. Kizzy. Happy birthday.
Thanks, yeah. Justar.
Your voice, we need more of you. Dane, incredible. Hill, I'm so honoured. Honestly, you know how much I've wanted you forever. And
I'm so glad that I could come because this was amazing. And you are amazing and I adore you.
We've got to meet at 2 o'clock in the morning sometime.
I'm out of here. Hill, thanks, guys.
If we're not already, we need to connect because some of our poetry is quite similar. I can't remember who I have on Facebook and who I don't.
I don't think I have you, but I think I've seen you around because we have friends in common. So I will just add you right now.
Please do.
Absolutely.
Yeah, please do. I love the links of all different parts of my poetry friendship today and the important ones are here. And I'm going to go away and cry.
Gary, go to sleep. Get some rest. And
I know. I might be at work tomorrow at 7.
Whoa,
yeah. Go to bed, please. Get some rest.
Tell him, Leslie, please. You don't listen
I'm to doing me. A one-on-one with this. See all the scratches and arms.
I'll get my mum on you. She's scary and she cares about you.
Oh, well, I like your mum. I like your mum. Just thank you. As I said, I'm really apologise. I just wasn't on my game this week, but I love you all. I will be in contact with you. Bye.
Bye. Bye bye, everyone.
Hannah, we got to talk.
I need to leave button, but I might end the meeting for all the reason, yeah?
Yeah, I'm going anyway, yeah. Knackered.
Yeah. I've sent you a message. Obviously, it's just a thing I've heard. But
Yeah, I smelt that, to be fair, yeah, so thank you.
I think we're still recording, but I'll get Gary to, like, cut that off.